Brent Musburger.
Good afternoon, everyone. Last night in New York City, the Yankees made it back to the World Series for the third straight year. And then in Dodger Stadium, earlier in the afternoon, this was the scene. It was the 10th inning. Ron Say was on second base for the Dodgers after Maddox could not field his line drive in center field. Tug McGraw hung the curveball. Russell with a line drive to center field. And Say came around with the run that gave the Dodgers the one-run victory and sent them back to the World Series for the second straight year. And it was a jubilant Tommy Lasorda who greeted his troops. And earlier today, on one of our pregame shows, we spoke live to the manager of the Los Angeles Dodgers, who was with his lovely wife, Jo Lasorda. And I asked Tommy if it feels as good the second time around.
Oh, absolutely, Brent. It's just tremendous. I'm so proud of our ball club. Coming from behind the Giants in Cincinnati, 6.5 games, it is a remarkable victory, and they did such a great job. I'm so very, very proud of them.
Whatever you've been feeding Steve Garvey, Pete Rose says, keep on feeding it to him for the next couple of weeks.
The Iron Horse has just been great. He's just so consistent, and all of them, they all played a very, very important part in this Express 2 victory.
What was the turning point in Tommy Lasorda's mind yesterday?
Well, I thought there were a couple. Doug Rao getting out of the bases loaded, no out situation in the first inning really helped us. And I thought the two home runs by Say and, of course, Penguin keeping us in the ballgame, the real good clutch relief pitching of Roden, and above all, the tremendous base hit that Russell got, but unfortunately, it had to come before Gary Maddox dropped the fly ball.
Tom, what will be your pitching rotation for the first 3 or 4 games?
Well, I don't know right now, Brent. We're going to decide on that probably tomorrow. So we can let you know more about it tomorrow.
Is there anyone that you confer with tonight about that selection? Someone you might like?
I'm going to ask Jo who she thinks I should pitch come Tuesday against the Yankees.
I think I'd start with Hooten.
Oh, Bert Hooten. Brent, that was a good choice. What do you think, Pete?
Hooten's a good choice.
And I want to say one thing to you, Pete. You had a great year. You really kept baseball alive in the National League. But I want to tell you this. I see where Johnny Bench is working on TV. You're helping Brent. Tom Stever's going to do the World Series. Me and all of our players, Pete, we're going to do everything we can.
Keep
to
on
keep
working.
Keep you guys working every year.
All right.
Thank you.
Tommy and Joe, thank you very much, and good luck in the World Series against the New York Yankees. Pete, let's go back to that first inning sequence yesterday that Tommy Lasorda referred to.
Well, what a situation for the Phillies to be in. Basically, loaded 2-0 on the home run hitter. You don't have a power pitcher pitching. Rao's not a strikeout pitcher, so you expect Lozinski to hit the ball. Even if he hits into a double play, they still get a run. And he made a great changeup pitch and struck out Greg Lozinski. And he had the next guy, Cardinal, 2-0, who hit a line drive to short, which almost resulted into a double play. But Boa got back underneath the tag and the next guy. There's a strike three. It's a changeup down. Good pitch. He's throwing him all fastballs away until that time.
All right. Pete, let's change to the American League because there was a moment of high controversy. Wilson is on second base for Kansas City last night. Thurman makes a fine stab, as you pointed out. But then what happens down at third base?
I think Willie Wilson made a tremendous slide, and he tucked his front foot under, and I think Nettles didn't get to him. Thurman made a great play. I think he's safe there, but you really can't blame the umpire. It was a very close play. But I think his front leg got to the bag before he tagged the back leg. Nettles tried to make a great play, but I think he was safe there, and I'm sure all the replays from all the angles will prove my point. And that's the difference, you know, when you're playing a one-run ball game or when you're playing against a team like the Dodgers or the Yankees, that's a big difference because there's only one out in that situation, and the next guy hit a fly ball, which he'd have scored on.
Who do you like, the Dodgers or the Yankees?
I like the Dodgers because they only have to face Guidry one time. He'll probably pitch Friday night's game, which will be the third game, and I just think the Dodgers are really playing well right now.
Jane, that means that your present for Pete Rose will work out.
It's completely appropriate. And this I brought to you, Pete, as a surprise. And this is from Brent and I out on the West Coast, and I want you to wear it.
I want to see Pete Rose in Dodger blue. Put that right on there.
Take this, Mr. O'Malley.
All right.
All right. Sparky will be on the next phone call.
Indeed. Hey, Irv Cross, let's get back to the National Football League. Who was our player of the week last week?
great.
There are a lot of candidates, Brent. Of course, Wilbert Montgomery in Philadelphia had a big day running the ball, and Joe Ferguson had a good day throwing the ball, but the Pro Football Writer shows Mark Mosley as the Schick Player of the Week. After the Washington kicker scored all the Redskins' points in their upset victory over Dallas last week, Brent, Mosley hit on field goals of 52, 42, and 27 yards in the 9-5 victory. His 52-yarder in the first period equaled the league's longest so far this year. Mosley's noted, though, for his accuracy at longer distances. Last year, he had 4 of the 8 field goals in the league, which went over 50 yards. He signed as a free agent in 1974, and because of his effort last week, he's chosen as our Schick Player of the Week.
Irv, we've got stars all over the place. Jane Kennedy will be back with Warren Beatty as the NFL Today continues on CBS in just a moment.
Tug McGraw out of shape. They're nuts. I'm tough as nails.
They mean Schick Shape, Tug. Schick Shape.
Get clean, get close, get comfort too. Get your face in Schick Shape.
Only Schick's Super 2 Twin Blades are Schick Sharp for incredibly close, clean shaves.
Great shape, Tug.
That's Schick Shape.
That's Schick Super 2.
Gentlemen, you've just got lucky. I've got your number. Call 45. I've got the dynamite taste. Call 45. Unique and sleek.
Cold and bold. Make it your lucky number.
I've got your number. Call 45.
As a State Farm agent, when people come into my office and sign an application for insurance, my job is just beginning. There's no sitting back and putting the file away.
Agent Vince Gramarosa talks about State Farm service.
We're continually reviewing their protection. We're continually talking to them. It's on a personal service basis from day to day, month to month. We never forget the people.
And like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
The Pittsburgh Steelers are about to win for the 6th straight time. As you check the scoreboard, 31-0, they have dominated the Falcons. New England and Philadelphia. Eagles are much tougher this year, but the Patriots lead by 10 in the 4th. Here's the major upset. Just over 5 minutes to go, the Lions have scored 19-14 over the Redskins at the moment. The Jets will win easily. 45-7, they lead in the 4th quarter. Chicago and Green Bay battling for the NFC Central leadership, and the Packers are up by a field goal. Tampa Bay and Kansas City, the Buccaneers lead 10-3 in the 3rd quarter. And St. Louis will go 0-6 apparently at the half, 21-10, Baltimore. Cleveland and New Orleans, Sam Ratigliano has brought that football team around, 14-9 over the Saints at the half. Let's now check in live around the league with some of our announcers, and I'm going to stay on baseball for the time being as we check in with Vin Scully in Seattle, Minnesota, getting ready. Vin, what about the World Series, the Dodgers and the Yankees?
Well, I have to say, and I'm not copying a plea, but in this day and age of inflation, the cheapest thing is still an opinion. I really don't have one. I've looked at the Dodgers all year. I haven't seen the Yankees. Last year during the World Series, I was doing football. I'm probably the least qualified person in America to tell you about the outcome of the series.
All right, then pay attention to those two scrambling quarterbacks this afternoon in Seattle, Vinny, and have a good day.
Okay.
Let's go down now to Lindsey Nelson down in the Coliseum. Lindsey, what do you think about the World Series, the Yankees and the Dodgers?
Well, Brent, even though I live in New York, I don't see the Yankees either because I spend my time with the New York Mets, but I'm a National Leaguer. So I always think the National League is going to win right up to the time they lose to the American League, but I think the Dodgers will win.
All right. Thank you very much, Lindsey. Let's check in with Pat Summerall, who is preparing for the Dallas Cowboys and the New York Giants. Pat, last Monday, the Cowboys, particularly when they got inside the 5, were very conservative. Are they going to open up a little bit more against the Giants? What have you heard in Dallas?
Well, Brent, I've been here a couple of days. I don't think that they think they're too conservative. I think the real element that's been a surprise in Dallas is that the Cowboys feel that everybody's playing over their heads against them. But I think that's a surprise to me because once you become the champion of the world, you expect everybody to be up and play well against you. I think they've been a little bit shocked at the caliber of the opponents that they've had so far and how well they've played.
Pat, how about the Giants, on the other hand? They lost by 10 up here in New Jersey, and they seem to be improving.
They've been able to move the ball, particularly against Dallas, and teams, in fact, the last 4 weeks, wide receivers have had very good days against the Cowboys, Yeah, you might remember that Johnny Robinson of the Giants started that trend, and since then it's been Mel Gray and those likes. So people have been able to throw against Dallas, and that's a major concern.
All right, Pat, thank you very much. Shane Kennedy, what were you doing talking to Warren Beatty about football?
Well, the film Heaven Can Wait has some great football footage in it, and I use that excuse. The film sequences were shot during halftime of a Rams game, and the people didn't know what was going on. They thought he was a real quarterback out there on the field.
And you tell me that he didn't use a double in the major football scene.
No, he liked it too much. Warren Beatty's new comedy, Heaven Can Wait, is chock full of magical moments. Hello.
Yes.
But there is no deception involved in the film's many fine football sequences. Unlike other full-length features with athletic portrayal, Heaven Can Wait's football sequences smacks of the real thing, especially Warren Beatty's performance as the quarterback for the Los Angeles Rams. Everybody's talking about Heaven Can Wait, but most of the people that I talk to in sports are raving about the football sequences. How did you manage that?
I guess if it looks good, the reason it looks good is that all those guys that I was playing with were, you know, all pros. They were Deacon, Marv Fleming, Jim Bokey, you know, a lot of guys that were, you know, had been all pro, as a matter of fact.
Your performance was so natural and so realistic. You didn't use a double at all, and you did all your own stunts.
In various fits of hysteria, I tried desperately to get in shape, you know, before this thing, and I had a guy who could double me. The more we went on, the less I wanted to be doubled. We actually didn't use any footage of the double. I got in real good shape for the beginning of the picture, but then when you're, you know, producing and you're directing and you're rewriting and you're acting, you tend to turn into a large piece of yogurt, you know? It's just everything kind of goes after about 8 or 9 weeks, and I had the vague feeling that I was producing and directing my own death there. I had to pick up a fumble, you know, and run 61 yards down the sideline, and I had a lot of guys who were really a lot faster and a lot stronger than me coming after me, and then go off the field on these people's shoulders, you know. It was all a little silly. It was sort of like a nightmare, I guess.
How do you accept the fact that a lot of professional athletes are raving about your ability, your performance?
I'll accept it quickly.
Because Pat Hayden had some great things to say about it.
He did, huh?
Yes, he did.
It's hard to believe.
I was impressed with some of the football scenes. I went in critical, but I've seen so many shows or movies where they have football scenes that are so unrealistic. But the one thing that impressed me about the film was I don't believe Warren Beatty used a double for the scenes where he was throwing the football. He looked pretty talented throwing the ball, and I think the Rams are going to give him a tryout.
Aladdin Stanley Thermos. Stanley, the tough, all-steel thermos bottle that's completely dependable and built to take a bounding year after year. Get the tough one, because a thermos bottle means more to you than a picnic. It's some kind of tough thermos bottle.
If we're to steer this operation right, we need computers. David, call the Giants.
Sir, let's call the Giant Killers. Wang.
If instant business information will help you run your business better, big or small, Wang has a computer system for you.
Avast the inventories. Hard right receivable.
Full profits ahead.
When I decided to go into the small cigar business, I didn't want to be second best. That's why.
Muriel Air Tips drive men mild with the easiest taste they could have found. And for something different, Muriel Coronella is the sweetest little miniature in town. Muriel, the biggest selling brand of small cigars around.
Because nobody wants to smoke second best.
Get great paint savings now during Ward Week.
We like to paint in autumn, before the holidays.
And we like to save money, so we paint it all ourselves and shop at Ward's. We save $4 a gallon on gallery semi-gloss and flat interior paint.
50 decorator colors, one coat cover, soap and water cleanup.
It's terrific paint. Ward's 6-foot, 5-position aluminum ladder is really handy, and it's 20% off.
So get painting.
You'll save at Ward's.
Irv Cross checked in this morning and he said, Brent, I think the Pack may indeed be back. 3-0, they are dominating Chicago right now in the third quarter.
In the third quarter, but I want to caution everybody, though. When you talk to head coach Bart Starr, he said, don't get overly optimistic. We haven't beaten a championship team yet, and until we do, we won't know how good we really are.
Well, so far, Chicago has had fumbleitis in that game. They turned the ball over 3 times in the first half, but this is what Irv found out earlier in the week in Green Bay.
During the 60s, Green Bay, Wisconsin became the focal point of professional football. It was the home of the Green Bay Packers, 5 times world champions, and aptly nicknamed Titletown, USA.
For a glorious decade, this squad exercised a winning habit no team before or since has equaled. It was a team of legendary characters, coached by the greatest legend of them all. The Packers brought national fame and instant recognition to a small community whose entire population could, at that time, fit in historic Lambeau Field.
Today, of course, there have been numerous changes, and most of the legends are gone. But the one who remains is doing his part to recapture the Green Bay Packer legacy. Head coach Bart Starr.
It has taken him 3 years, but Bart Starr has returned Packer pride. His team leads the NFC Central because of a wide-open attack and a defense that tops the NFL in quarterback sacks and interceptions. With Bart Starr directing this organization, the Packers' future will always be tied directly to their glorious past.
History and tradition play a big part in the success of any organization. We're very proud of our past here. We don't live in the past, but we're extremely proud of it, and we're trying to build on it. By the way, we're not intimidated by it either.
Starr's main goal has been to instill that which became a Packer trademark years ago, precise execution. It's no longer fullback Jim Taylor blocking down on the linebacker, but Barty Smith. And instead of guard Jerry Kramer leading the sweep, it's Darrell Goforth. The results, however, have been remarkably similar, as number 34, Terdell Middleton, is second in the NFC in rushing. Today, the Packer offense is a finesse attack, employing misdirection that initially indicates the play is going one way, only to have it come back to the other side of the field. Such deception has helped Green Bay win 4 of the first 5 games. Yet the Packers' sudden success is probably best explained by Green Bay quarterback David Whitehurst.
Well, one way I look at it is that a lot of the hard work we put in last year, we weren't winning for, is coming through for us. Maybe we're too young to realize what's happening to us, and, you know, as long as we keep playing football, we'll keep winning.
While it is true the Packers' schedule is getting dramatically tougher, there is little question these youngsters have taken a giant step towards returning this proud franchise to the mainstream of the NFL. For the first time in a long time, it's fun again in Titletown, USA.
And now the Packers have intercepted a pass on the Bears, and Barzalauskas put them down on the 11-yard line, and they have moved down to the 2-yard line now behind Barty Smith. So it looks as though the Pack will improve upon that 3-0 lead. You are looking at Barty Smith. This occurred just moments ago as he drove down to the 2-yard line. Now it is 2nd and goal. You are watching live the Packers with a record of 4-1 ahead of Chicago with a 3-2 mark. The Bears having won their first 3 games. They've lost their last 2 in a row. Whitehurst at quarterback now for Bart Starr. Middleton goes into the middle of the line, and the officials will unpile them there at the goal line. The officials have asked for a timeout before they spot the ball. That was a 2nd and goal. And you can take still another look. A straight-ahead power player across behind Barty Smith.
Barty Smith picked up a great lead block there. Looks like he might have had enough penetration across the goal line, but apparently he didn't quite make it, Brent.
Now the Bears sending in some defensive linemen from the sideline. This will be 3rd and goal. You are watching live from Lambeau Field in Green Bay. The Packers ahead by a Mark Hole field goal, 3-0, and Whitehurst brings them to the line. Middleton, 34, is at the left. Barty Smith directly behind Middleton. Smith, fumble. I think the Packers may have jumped back on it, though, Irv. It was indeed the quarterback, David Whitehurst, number 17, and Barty Smith is there, who recovered it. And now comes one of those moments. This is a fourth and goal coming up. Barty going up over the top, lost control, and fumbled. So now, will they go for the field goal by Marcole, or will they gamble for the touchdown? Here it is. They're spotted on the two-yard line. Tommy Hart is the man who crashed into him with that arm tackle. They're going to go for it. This is fourth and goal, live from Green Bay, Wisconsin. 3-0, Packers lead the Bears. On the sweep, Middleton. He's across for the touchdown. And the Green Bay Packers have scored, and the NFL today will continue on CBS in just a moment.
Danish heritage of American-brewed Tuborg Gold. Never go for bronze or silver. Live to make the most of every day. Go for the gold. Then taste the triumph of Danish brewing. Tuborg Gold. You make the most of every day. Go for the gold. Tuborg Gold.
I see terrible things.
My future?
Your clothes. You'd look better in Hager slacks. Or a Hager sport coat and slacks. Even a Hager vested suit. All of today's Dacron polyester at prices that won't cost you a fortune. Now I see a romance. Uh-huh. A beautiful woman.
My girlfriend.
My daughter. Emelsha!
Hager, because looking good makes you feel good. For over 30 years, people have been buying Poland chainsaws.
Wouldn't use anything but a Poland.
Poland, Ed. Poland.
And for over 30 years, they've been mispronouncing our name.
Poland. Poland.
So we'd like to remind you that our name is Poland. And for a tough, dependable chainsaw, Poland is the only name you need to remember, no matter how you pronounce it.
Poland.
Jimmy the Greek is sponsored by Dutch Master Cigars. They really are masters at Dutch Masters.
All right, the extra point was good, and it is 10-0 right now. Packers, the Redskins have just scored on Detroit. They lead them 20-19, and Greek, Minnesota and Seattle, that should be an entertaining game.
No question about it. The Vikings have started becoming my favorite team.
What a surprise.
Let's give Tarkenton a real pat on the back. He's playing super ball. You know, I've knocked him a lot of times, but he has been playing super. I think they've got too much right here for Seattle.
On the special teams. Right. All right, now let's roll up San Francisco at Los Angeles. The unbeaten... Hey, Greek, you ran out of checks.
Yeah, I know. I did for Washington, too, against Detroit. But the only way that Los Angeles could lose this would be complacency of some sort. I think DeBerg will throw for about 3 interceptions today.
All right. Now, we've got the New York Giants and the Dallas Cowboys. That's our main doubleheader game. Cowboys trying to come back from that Monday night disappointment.
What are you going to say about Dallas? They're supposed to win everything, and consequently, they haven't been playing so well, and they even choked last week against Washington. But I think they'll come back today.
The Giants, though, they've been improving, Greg.
That's your opinion, not mine.
Let me see how the Greek at razor's edge. Jimmy's got Denver over San Diego and favored Oakland over Houston. Prohibitive favorite, Miami over Cincinnati tomorrow night. Back with the Greek's grapevine and the Cincinnati Bengals as the NFL Today continues in just a moment.
The Dutch Masters buyers are in France for the international auction of rare African Cameroon tobacco. There are two secrets they must keep to win some of the best leaf for Dutch Masters. The exact leaf they want and the price they'll pay.
It's a nice color.
When their bid is opened by the French auctioneers, they'll learn if they've won some of the best.
Acheteur Dutch Masters.
Taste the taste the world competes for in a Dutch Masters Cameroon whiff. There really are masters at Dutch Masters.
Jimmy, you told me a couple weeks ago that Forrest Gregg was going to be the next coach down at Cincinnati. What happened?
Well, it's the interim coach that just took over. But don't worry about it. He'll take over Cincinnati at the beginning of the next season. Isn't that right, Mr. Brown?
Listen, Cincinnati has had a bad time. St. Louis, an awful time. How's Wilkins to get along with the front office of the Cardinals?
He's had a little problem with Sullivan and the owner the other day over Jay Smith. Remember the tight end that used to play? He wanted to sign him up, and he didn't pass the test for St. Louis. But you know what I can't understand?
What's that, Jimmy?
He passed the test for Dallas. So I think something might have happened there.
All right. There is just over a minute left in the Washington-Detroit game. It has been a dandy. Theismann's pass and the extra point put the Redskins up by 2, 21-19. You're getting ready for the second half of a big doubleheader on CBS. And at halftime of these games, we'll be talking to Pete Rose, not only about the World Series, but about Pete Rose. He has played out his option with the Cincinnati Reds. Where will he go this year?
Japan.
So for Jane Kennedy and Irv Cross, and Jimmy the Greek, and Pete Rose, I'm Brent Musburger, and we certainly hope that you've enjoyed the NFL Today on CBS.
Stay tuned as the NFL Today continues after this word from your local station. The NFL on CBS. Today's game is sponsored by Ford and your Ford dealer, who are introducing the all-new LTD and Mustang. Easy-tasting Budweiser, the king of beers. When you say Budweiser, you've said it all. And by AC Delco, quality automotive parts for quality motoring. AC Delco. Stay tuned as the NFL Today continues after this word from your local station.
If you think some of today's passes have been exciting, wait till you see the plays made for me on WKRP in Cincinnati.
Tomorrow at 8, 7 Central and Mountain.
This is CBS.
The social event of the year is the Tuck Shop's annual fall clearance sale. And visit the new Tuck Shop opening on the Capitol Mall in Olympia.
The aluminum can. It has what America wants, convenience. But it also has what America needs, the ability to save resources and energy because it's recyclable. Recycle an aluminum can and you save about 95% of the energy needed to make aluminum from scratch. And you get paid to do it. The aluminum can, it's too good to throw away.
This is JCPenney.
This Monday only, you save on Posture Builder mattresses. Sold only in sets, you save $40 to $60. Twin sets, $99.90. Full sets at $149.90. And comfortable queen sets at $199.95. Hurry, these are limited to stock on hand. Monday only at JCPenney.
This is JCPenney.
We're alive with the spirit of the Great Northwest.
From the King Dome in Seattle, Washington, CBS Sports presents the Minnesota Vikings and the Seattle Seahawks. Hi, everybody. I'm Vin Scully, along with George Allen and Jim Brown. Minnesota, a fine organization battling the inroads of age. Seattle, an expansion franchise just starting to get it together. Gentlemen, the question before the house. Can we have an upset today, Jim?
Yes, very definitely, Vinny. Whenever Chuck Foreman is not going to play, as they say he's not, there is a chance for an upset. But, Coach, from a coaching point of view, what do you think about that?
Well, Jim, the Vikings won't beat themselves. They don't make that many mistakes. They're a solid team. They're well coached. I think Jim Zorn has improved as a passer. He's reading the defense and taking what the defense gives him.
Oh, yes. So you think that it's not going to be an upset?
I think that... Seattle will have a difficult time running against the Viking defense. If Zorn has a hot day and Seattle doesn't make many mistakes, they have a chance.
Yes, last week they had about 5 turnovers. You can't win in this league with 5 turnovers. But the Vikings have some problems. Jim Marshall is about 40 years old. Carl Eller is not going to start, and there's talk about trading Alan Page.
Those Vikings are just the age I like. They remind me of the Redskins.
Well, they tell me that Bud Grant is probably the only coach in the National Football League that has a philosophy similar to yours. What do you say about that?
Well, I like his approach. I think the Viking organization is a sound one, and I've admired Max Winter over the years. He's a solid owner and a guy with class.
Well, Seattle has a couple of problems. Niehaus, who's considered their best player, is, well, not player, but their best lineman,
yes,
is not going to play today. Also, Smith is going to be back, Coach. He's the best runner. What do you think about a guy being out for about 3 weeks and then coming back?
The one thing there, Jim, is sometimes he makes a critical mistake. He fumbles or drops a key pass.
All right, let's go to Vince Scully.
Okay, JB and George A., they're about ready. And the Vikings won the toss. They will elect to receive. And so the Seattle Seahawks will try and stop Minnesota at the outset. Efren Herrera, formerly of Dallas and, of course, a most valuable asset up here, will be kicking off. And deep, you see Kevin Miller on the goal line. Sammy White is up in front of him, and Robert Miller is up front on the left.
Vinny, one thing that Efren does, he sprays his kickoffs all over the field so that it's difficult sometimes to organize a return.
All right, Minnesota with three rabbits back there to catch a spray kickoff. And Efren Herrera ready, and we're going to get this underway. Minnesota, three victories and two losses. Seattle, two victories and three losses. And Herrera's kick will go to the right side on the 10-yard line. It's Sammy White to the 20. And gets to the 23-yard line. Kevin Miller tried to throw the block on him, but he couldn't bring his man down. Let's take a look now at Minnesota on the offense. Frank Myers, Charles Goodrum, Mick Tinglehoff, Wes Hamilton, and Ron Yeary up front. The fellows who'll handle the football, Ahmad Rashad, Sammy White, and the tight end, Bob Tucker. At the wheel, Fran Tarkenton, the running backs, Ricky Young and Robert Miller. Chuck Foreman, a definite doubtful starter in today's game. So the first offensive play of the day, first and 10 on the Viking 23. White is left. Rashad wide left, and now Tarkenton looks left and going deep down the middle to Rashad. Broken up by John Harris. A fine play by the rookie out of Arizona State to break it up.
I like this call. Good opening play. A lot of time. The play action froze him. It looks like he has him beaten there. The ball's just a little short. Let him run underneath it. Excellent call.
John Harris, a seventh-round draft choice for Seattle, had 16 interceptions at Arizona State, so he has an eye for the football. Second and 10 on the 23 of Minnesota. Rashad wide right. Sammy White goes left. And it's Ricky Young running into people and getting to about the 26 and whack back. The first man to hit him is Terry Beeson. And we can have a look now at Seattle up front defensively. Ernie Price, along with Dennis Boyd, Bill Sandifer, and Bill Gregory. The linebackers, Sammy Green, Terry Beeson, and Keith Butler. At the corners, Keith Simpson in there for Cornell Webster, who has a bad shoulder. Then you have Dave Brown, Autry Beeman, who used to play for Minnesota, the strong safety, and John Harris. Wes Hamilton of Minnesota is down. Wes, a three-year man out of Tulsa. And it means that last year's draft choice, Dennis Swilly, will have to take over. You can take a look at this play, and we'll see. Take a look at number 62, Ernie Price. And Price evidently coming over the top, and you can see Hamilton grabbing his right knee. So timeout. At the wheel, Fran Tarkenton. George?
I love to watch Fran manipulate. He throws to the backs. He's a smart quarterback. He reads the coverages. He doesn't make mistakes. Jim, he's a master.
Coach, something I'd like to point out. I would like all of our fans to watch Tarkenton's legs and see if he has a limp. In my opinion, he is limping slightly. He doesn't have the maneuverability that he once had, but yet certain coaches says that he is much quicker now than he was before. Be interesting to see that.
Yeah, I think he still moves well. He doesn't move as quickly as he used to years ago, but he still moves enough to get away from the rush. You hate to see somebody come off with a knee injury, Benny.
Yes, Wes Hamilton, who has really earned the starting role, has to give way. Dennis Swilly, number 67, figures to fill in for him. So a big play, third and six from the 27. Tarkenton rolling right, looked at Robert Miller. Now still trying to get some help. Myers trying to block for him, and he finally unloads. No good. Intended for Ricky Young. And right there to break it up is Butler.
Yeah.
So Keith Butler, a second-year draft choice this year, makes the big play.
Now, Tarkenton, in my opinion, has a slight limp, but he still has the maneuverability. He looks, goes back. He's one of the few quarterbacks that goes back against the grain. He has that ability.
Yeah.
This pass is a well-thrown ball, but beautiful coverage.
This is difficult on the defense, difficult on the blockers. When a quarterback scrambles, you sometimes get the clips.
Rufus Crawford now on his wobbly punt.
There's a flag.
Gets down to the 40 and takes a Viking roll all the way inside the 20-yard line. Nate Allen finally downs it on the 19. Flag on the play, so let's crank up and go back and take
and
a look.
Benny and Jim, you never want that ball to hit the turf. Fair catch it. Don't let it bounce. When it bounces, you lose 15 to 25 yards every time.
Exactly what happened that time. It hit on around the 40 and wound up inside the 20.
They got a break. Seattle
Indeed.
Got a break.
Ineligible man downfield. That line, do you like that rule, George?
There are more penalties on the kicking game since they changed the rules.
Right.
And all it does is time onto the game. I think it's a very flimsy call, a judgment call. Sometimes they're only down maybe 6-7 inches, and yet they're downfield.
Mike Wood, out of Southeast Missouri State, was a field goal kicker in college. In fact, a couple of years ago, he kicked a 61-yard field goal. But he asked if he could compete for the punting job with Neil Clabo. And the next thing you know, Mike Wood won it. He's an eighth-round draft choice. He'll be kicking to Rufus Crawford at the Seattle 45. And this time he hits an arrow, and Crawford on his own 39-yard line. Rufus to the 45 and goes down before he can quite get to midfield. So Seattle will take over, first and 10, still in their own territory. And a reminder, the CBS Sports Spectacular upcoming next Saturday, 4:30 p.m. Eastern Time, 3:30 Central and Pacific. USTA Women's Indoor Tennis Championship, the Jockey Club, Gold Cup, all coming up next Saturday, along with the World's Strongest Men competition and an update on the baseball report. CBS Sports Spectacular next Saturday. Jim Zorn with McCollum wide left. Largent wide right. The running back, Sherman Smith, with Largent in motion to the left. And the first man through is David Sims, who figures to be a workhorse, and he moves it across midfield into Minnesota territory, so he picked up a couple. Up front, offensively for Seattle, Bebod, Lynch, Yarno, Newton, and August. The wide receivers, Sam McCollum and Steve Largent. The tight end is Ron Howard. And the running backs, along with Jim Zorn at the wheel, you have Sherman Smith and David Sims. An impatient Chuck Foreman, injured and at least not making a start. Second and 7 from the Viking 48. Zorn giving to Sherman Smith, and the big back gets just short of the 45-yard line. Sherman Smith had been banged up. He was the club's number one rusher last year. Here's Minnesota up front. Mark Mullaney, Doug Sutherland, Alan Page, and 40-year-old Jim Marshall. The linebackers, Matt Blair, Jeff Seaman, and Fred McNeil. At the corners, Nate Wright and Bobby Bryant. Strong safety is Phil Wise, and the free safety, Tom Hannon. Third and 5 on the Viking 46. And Zorn's gonna left-hand one up in the air. And he floats it, and he has his man across the 25-yard line, but there's a flag on the play as Steve Rabel made the reception, but hold on.
Against Seattle.
Here's a look at Rabel. 2 years ago, Rabel scored on an 80-yard touchdown pass against Minnesota. Unfortunately for Seattle, the flag goes down against them, so they lose a big gain.
Oh, that hurts at this time. Zorn showed a lot of poise there.
Number 83, offensive pass interference.
So Steve Rabel, who caught the pass, is guilty of the offensive rule infraction. Take a look in the lower left-hand corner.
Yeah, gee, it was kind of a flimsy call. He just brushed him a little bit. But
well, that's what the new rule does this year, George.
That's called incidental contact.
Third and 15 from the Viking 44. That pass covered 25 yards, so that was a big blow. Zorn making a pass to Sam McCollum with Bobby Bryant all over him. McCollum making a good reception, and Sam is in the Seattle history books. He caught the first touchdown in Seattle history.
You know, Zorn looks good. Zorn has improved. The last time I saw Zorn, he wasn't reading the defenses or throwing with that authority.
Fellas, I guess it's a little different to defense a left-handed quarterback. We can get into that in a little while, but right now, Thunderfoot, as they call him, Herman Weaver, 9-year veteran out of Tennessee, will do the punting. Going deep, you have Kevin Miller, and he's flanked by Tom Hannon and Nate Wright. So they keep some defensive backs in there just in case. Weaver really hit one up to the roof, and Kevin Miller on his own 9-yard line, and Rabel hit him immediately. So Steve Rabel, who figured prominently on the offensive interference, went down and made the hit.
Hang time of 4-9, Vinny. Hang time of 4-9. Tremendous.
While the Duns sleep, an evil thing happens. A pasty film covers their mouths, teeth. They wake with the worst breath of the day.
Morning.
Mouthwash. Scope?
I use mine.
Yours leaves your breath medicine-y. Smell. Not minty like Scope.
But mine clean.
Can't clean your mouth better than Scope.
All right. Clean?
Morning.
Scope fights bad breath. Doesn't give medicine breath.
Good old Charlie, that's me. Somebody's got a dead battery and they call good old Charlie and I jumpstart him. Rain, snow, day, night. Well, this time I tell them, get your own diehard.
The maintenance-free diehard has extra power to start your car when most batteries won't.
This is the last time.
Thank you, Charlie.
Oh, anytime.
The diehard, sold only at Sears.
There's Herman Weaver out of Tennessee, a 9-year veteran called Thunderfoot. How about that kick, fellas?
Yes, Vinny, it was 37 yards, but that's not really important. The hang time is what's important. Well, how do you explain that, Coach?
Well, he hung the ball 4.9. When you hang it that high, you're not going to be able to return it. About all you can do is fair catch it.
First and 10 from the 10, and Tarkenton going to the air has Ricky Young, and then there are three Seattle Seahawks who have Young and bring him down as he crosses the 15.
And going back to that kicking game again, Woods' hang time on his first punt was only 3.9, so that gave Seattle good field position.
And you're talking about seconds.
Yes.
Well, we just saw Tarkenton there. Now, talking about Tarkenton, he throws a lot of passes behind the line to his backs. A lot of people criticize that, but that's a very difficult chore to do. The only other quarterback that could do it as well as Tarkenton was Norman Van Brocklin.
That's smart football, tough to defense.
Second and 4 from the 17. Here comes Robert Miller. And down he goes, and a good play that time by Ernie Price, number 62, 6-year man out of Texas A&I. Watch him stack it up.
From ground level, we watch Miller. You can see that the defense is stringing it out. He's got a lot of problems there. He can't really make a move. The turf is a little slippery. Cuts back in. He's looking all the time, and he's getting ready for the hit now. You can see that head go down. He gave it up.
Good defense, good pursuit, no chance.
Third and 3 from the 18-yard line, and we'll see what Francis comes up with now. Robert Miller is the only running back as Young in motion to the right. Tarkenton looking for Miller and just missed an interception as Brown came up out of nowhere. Dave Brown just missed.
Let's say that Fran Tarkenton is a very wise man, or either he had a bad throw. If that throw was good, it probably would have been an interception.
Well, he wanted the outside receiver, and they took it away. They came up and jammed the wide receiver, so he had to take the back.
So Mike Wood is asked to punt for the second time. He'll be kicking from his 5-yard line, and Rufus Crawford all alone, single safety at midfield for Seattle. 10 minutes left in the first period, no score. Poor kick by Wood. That's going to hit on the 43-yard line of Minnesota, go out of bounds at the 44, and so Seattle will put it in play. First and 10 on the Minnesota 44-yard line. Friends' telecast presented by authority of the National Football League, intended for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast or other use of this telecast without the express written consent of the Seattle Seahawks and the National Football League is prohibited. A wobbly punt good for only 27 yards.
Seattle has had great field position both times. Now they have to take advantage of it early or the tide will change the other way.
First and 10 from the 44. McCollum is wide right, Largent in motion right. Play action fake to Smith, and Zorn is going broke. Down in the end zone to McCollum. Touchdown! Sam McCollum, a ninth round draft choice by Minnesota in 1974, scores against the Vikings.
I said they had to take advantage of that field position, and he did in a hurry. When we defensed, here it is, Seattle, our number one rule was stop Sam McCollum deep. Don't worry about the short one. Stop him deep. Beautiful throw on the button.
The play action held up the defense just a slightly bit, George.
Now here's Efren Herrera following a 44-yard touchdown pass, and it looked like Minnesota was in motion, but let's double-check. Flags dropping. Sam McCollum, a five-year man out of Montana State, able to beat the Minnesota defense. And evidently, Minnesota was drawn off, and the penalty.
That's trouble. They play over their heads. We now got the possibility of that type of game.
Fred Silva is the referee. Let's listen to his call.
54, false start.
False start by Art Kuhn, the center, causing Minnesota to jump off. So Herrera now will try for the point after spotted from the 15-yard line. And it's knocked down. And it is number 25, Nate Allen, who came in to smother it for Minnesota.
He kicked a line drive, Vinny.
And there's Nate Allen blurred, but he got his hands on it to knock it down. So with 9:47 left in the first quarter, Seattle 6 and Minnesota nothing.
Nobody does it better than Hurts.
Nobody does it better. Hurts leads the others by far. Nobody does it best of all you. Hurts, the superstar.
Nobody has more of what it takes to rent you a Fairmont, Mustang, LTD, or other fine car faster.
Hurts, the superstar.
You know it.
You must be ready for a beer.
I'm ready for a new Schlitz Light.
There's a new taste in Schlitz Light. The taste of natural ingredients brewed into a Pilsner beer. New Schlitz Light. Still less filling with a taste that's bigger than light.
We climbed it because it was there.
And we came back down because this was here.
Schlitz Light. Natural Pilsner beer.
A poor punt. A 27-yard punt by Mike Wood. A 44-yard touchdown pass from Jim Zorn to Sam McCollum. This is Ben Scully along with George Allen and Jim Brown with 9:47 left to go in the first quarter. And Seattle leading Minnesota 6-0. Efren Herrera will kick it off after Nate Allen blocked the point after. Kevin Miller is deep, flanked by Sammy White and Robert Miller. And Herrera again hooking this one to the right side. Kevin Miller from the 6 to the 25. Bumps into people and goes down at the 30-yard line. And the man who hit him actually was number 59, Charles McShane. A reminder, Tuesday night, The Paper Chase, a marvelous show indeed, followed by Jacqueline Suzanne's bestseller, Once Is Not Enough. That's a winning lineup Tuesday night right here on CBS. The Paper Chase followed by Once Is Not Enough. Well, the question is, one certainly doesn't figure to be enough. One touchdown to stop Minnesota. Rashad wide left, Sammy White right. The running backs are Young and Robert Miller. First and 10 from the 30. And there goes Robert Miller, fumbles. And it looked like Seattle recovered, unless it was after the whistle. No, sir. Seattle's Dennis Boyd, number 68. Big guy at 6'6", falls on the football. Here's Robert Miller, number 35.
Nice blocking, a good hole there. He gets hit from the side, decided he had the ball in, Jim, and hit it right on the elbow and the ball, jarred it loose.
Dennis Boyd came in to cover that fumble very well. You always teach that to always be looking for the ball.
Good field position for the Seahawks. Remember, they had it on the 44 and scored. Now they have it on the Viking 42. Sims and Smith in the backfield. McCullum is wide right, Largent left. The tight end Howard on the left side, and Smith gets the 40 and draws to the 39-yard line. Matt Blair on top of him. Fred McNeil and Jim Marshall also hit him.
We're talking about Smith. It's very good that he's back in the lineup, although he might be a little rusty. His timing might be a little bad. But for the, from the standpoint of morale, we're always glad to have him there.
Yes, I see Kramer sitting on his helmet. That was just a little thing that I never wanted my players to do, is sit on their helmet. They cost too much, and they get them out of shape. Go down to one knee.
Second and eight on the 40-yard line. Zorn's going to left-hand it up, gets his protection, throws, and it is dropped. Ferguson had his hands on it. Nate Wright jolted it loose. So Duke Ferguson unable to hold on to it.
That's a real good defensive play. The pass is completed. The receiver comes back, and the defender slaps at the ball, goes for the elbow. You see that?
That's 43, Wright.
Now watch that.
Does a great job.
If you try to make the tackle, it's completed. So you go for the ball, go for the elbow, jar it loose.
Third and eight from the Viking 40.
You're saying that they're well coached, right, Coach?
Large and left with Rabel on a wing, and McCullum goes wide right. Both backs go out, so Zorn's on his own, and it's partially deflected and drops harmlessly to the earth. The big hands of Mark Mullaney, I believe, number 77, got up to knock it down.
One of the rules in rushing a passer, Jim, is to get your hands up if you can't get in there. Make them throw out of a well, and this is what happens. Good coverage. Watch the deflected ball. Got his hands up and deflected it.
And there's Mark Mullaney, a four-year man out of Colorado State. He'd been waiting to get a start, finally got it after 3 years when Carl Illa broke a thumb. So Herman Weaver will be punting now from midfield. And there is Kevin Miller standing on his own 10, flanked by Nate Wright and Tom Hannon. And Weaver trying to hang an arrow, and there'll be no return. It's a question as it goes into the end zone. So Minnesota will put it in play, first and 10 from its own 20-yard line, and they finally stop the Hawks. Final score, New England 24, Philadelphia 14. Steve Grogan, a little too much for Ron Jaworski and company. Pittsburgh starting to sharpen up, and they demolished Atlanta 31-7. Final. It was almost an upset, and Washington pulled it out. Detroit led 19-14, and Washington comes out on top 21-19, and Jack Pardee still undefeated. So first and 10 for Minnesota on their own 20-yard line.
There's Jack Patera on the sidelines.
Rashad going wide left, Sammy wide right. Robert Miller, the only back with Tucker now, and in motion is Ricky Young. Play action fake and a flip to Ricky Young. Slowed down at the line of scrimmage, and down he goes. Simpson was the man who stopped the play. Keith Simpson, a rookie out of Memphis State, number 48 for Seattle.
Play action screen there, Jimmy. Good first down call. The Vikings have to get something going on offense. Seattle's had tremendous field position. The Vikings defense that last series came through in a critical situation.
Keith Simpson is playing for Cornell Webster, who is banged up. Simpson, an All-American out of Memphis State. Second and 7 on the Viking 23-yard line. Robert Miller finding some daylight, finally hit by Sammy Green and brought down, as he is just shy of the 30-yard line, and he has to get to the 30 for the first down. Robert Miller.
Vinny, that last punt was in the air for 5 seconds. Wood's last punt. When he gets a hold of me, he rides him. You can't return that type of
Herman
ball.
Weaver.
Yes.
Third down and just about that much, about a yard. The ball on the Viking 29-yard line. It's 6-0 Seattle, 7:24 to go in the first. Craig, another tight end in there now as they go for the yardage, and Robert Miller gets across the 30, and even though they push him back, he got to the 31. That means first down.
Now, we can watch the attitude of Robert Miller. He has good body lean. The blocking is basically wedge blocking. The line is just really driving him out. He hits the split. He's a little high, but he spins to compensate for it and falls for the first down.
Terry Beeson, number 58, either made or broke that play, and when Miller was able to get away from Beeson, he picked up the first down. First and 10 on the Minnesota 32-yard line. Young and Miller, the running backs, and it's Robert Miller. Spins and falls down after Bill Sandifer first made contact just behind the line of scrimmage. Green Bay and Chicago, and we saw Washington dodge a bullet, but Chicago is hurting. Green Bay, surprisingly, with David Whitehurst, and happy times for Bart Starr, 24-7. Tampa Bay holding on to a four-point lead over Kansas City, 10-6 in the fourth. Second and 10 from the Viking 32. They started on their own 20. Miller and Young and Sammy White in a slot inside Rashad, and here comes Miller spinning, but Beeson holding, and he got away from Beeson again across the 35 to about the 37. So Terry Beeson unable to hold on to him.
Tarkenton's trying to get that running game going, establish his running game before he throws. Now this situation, the Vikings usually end up with some form of a formation with just one remaining back, or they get that formation by the use of motion. And then Tarkenton does a good job on this down of sprinting out or rolling out. Let's see what he does.
Third and six from the 36. Slot right, White inside Rashad. Tarkenton looked right, then down the middle, still looking off people, and he's being pursued by Ernie Price, and he outfaked Price for the moment. He finally unloads, and it's complete to Sammy White, who is ridden out of bounds by Sammy Green.
Great job by Tarkenton.
Ernie Price chased him all over the lot.
Now, we can see Tarkenton, and now we're going to get a chance to see his maneuverability. I had doubts about it, but on this particular play, this is the Tarkenton of old. All right, there's the hesitation, the move back, the spin back. The lineman, you can see there, is having all of the trouble in the world. And finally, he spots his receiver, hits him on the money. That's the Fran talking to Vol.
All of his receivers break in the direction that he is running.
So a pickup of 14 yards to move it across midfield into Seattle territory. First and 10, the Seahawk 49. Tarkenton looking to the right, throwing to Rashad, and he's knocked out of bounds by Simpson. Ahmad Rashad, of course, known up around these parts as Bobby Moore when he went to school at Oregon. Cleveland sitting on top of New Orleans 21-9 in the fourth quarter. And Baltimore leading the Cardinals 24-17 in the third. I think that marks the return of Bert Jones. Second and two for Minnesota. They started on their own 20-yard line. They have the ball on the Seattle 42. Rashad left and White right. Young and Robert Miller still in there, and they both stay in to block. Tarkenton cranking up for the long pass to Sammy White. No good. And Johnny Harris, number 44, at the last moment, stuck his finger in the pie and broke it up.
Yeah. Great defensive play, and Tarkenton had a delivery hit here just as he released the ball. He gets whacked here and goes down. Good throw. Fine defensive play.
They put a little sandwich on him, too, and there's Harris just knocking it away.
Knocking the ball down rather than tipping it up.
Both of them are rookies, Keith Simpson out of Memphis State and John Harris out of Arizona State, and the two rookies were able to shut out Sammy White on that play. Third and two from the Seattle 41. Uh-oh, fumble by Robert Miller, but he turned around and fell on top of it, and I'm not sure if it was just Miller's fumble or a sloppy handoff.
Well, then it was a quick count. Quick count, and he didn't get the ball.
Tarkenton actually put the ball on the knee of Miller.
Looked a little
low. Once in a while, a quarterback will put it low. That's the worst place you can almost put it.
Well, many times when you go on sound, going a quick count like that, you see that the ball was slipping from his hand.
Right, it was a sloppy handoff.
Before the back received it.
So it'll be fourth and three. They actually lost a yard and a half on the Seattle 42. Rufus Crawford standing all alone on his 10. Mike Wood, who had only a 27-yard punt, and that set up the Seattle touchdown. And we'll see how he will do from his own 45. Under a little pressure, but he got it away, and a much better one. Crawford at the 10, to the 15, and dragged down. And Randy Holloway made the initial hit, a fine defensive play. The two coaches here today, Jack Patera and Bud Grant. Jack Patera, perhaps the least known of the two, graduate of the University of Oregon, played for Baltimore, the Bears, and Dallas. He was a guard and a linebacker. He's been a head coach here since January of 76. He was 2-12 the first year, 5-9 last year, and he has them 2-3 and leading today.
He's done a good job here, Vinny. He's rebuilt this team along with John Thompson very well.
First and 10 from the 17 for the Hawks. Play action fake to Sims. Zorn has some time and hits Ron Howard, the tight end. He's to the 30, 35, 40-yard line. Jeff Seaman dragged him down from behind.
Howard makes a very good cutback here. Now, as Zorn looks,
all day to
he
throw
finally
it, yeah.
finds Howard. Yes, the pressure is not there. Howard has his eyes open. His head is up. He saw the block. He cut back. Doesn't seem to have great speed, but doesn't really need it.
He never caught a pass when he was with Dallas. He was a special teams man. But up here now, as a tight end, he's getting some work.
The play action held him there.
First and 10 from the 40. The Hawks trying to move out. This time it's Smith, and he gets to about the 43-yard line. Fred McNeil and Jeff Seaman, Phil Hannon, they all had a grab of him. When you talk about the Vikings, you have to talk about 50-year-old Bud Grant. 107 victories. He's been head coach of the Vikes since 1967. Won 9 Central Division championships in 11 years. Remarkable coach, remarkable man.
Well,
graduate,
he's got,
University of Minnesota.
He's got a consistent program. He doesn't change. The players know what to expect. He's working with a fine owner.
Second and 7 from the Hawk 43. Zorn with his backs going out, dumps it to Sims, and Sims trying to run over Krause, and he did. To the 35, to the 30. He just ran right over the veteran safety man, Paul Krause, and broke it wide open.
Well, the Vikings dogged on this. They blitzed. Zorn hit the second back, and you have to play that second back a little tighter so you don't have that open field tackle. Now watch this. There's the second back, Sims coming around.
Now this is one of the most difficult plays for a defensive back, one-on-one in the open. Paul Krause is not known as the greatest tackler in the world. He's much greater as far as interceptions.
First and 10 on the Viking 32. This drive started on the Seattle 17. Largent in a slot right inside Ferguson. And there goes Smith, and he's inside the 20. Oh, did they tear open a hole in the Minnesota front four?
Well, they have the Vikings on defense. Fast trap on Page. Good call. Smith, their best back, carrying the ball.
On the opening of the show, Coach, we were talking about that Viking defense.
Sherman Smith has been out
yes.
with a bad knee. He's the number one rusher from last year, and he's leading the way.
Right now, Zorn is mixing his calls beautifully. He has the Vikings guessing on defense.
First and 10, and here goes Smith inside the 15-yard line. McNeil has him on one side, and Blair has him at the other.
There it is the other way, a fast trap the other way. They're hitting direct, quick hitting plays.
Sherman Smith, a second round draft choice in 76. He's out of Miami of Ohio. In fact, he was a quarterback in his college days. Zorn rolling to his right and gonna take off to the 5, touchdown. Zorn, that would be his third rushing touchdown along with 6 passing touchdowns this year.
This is a perfect play to see the total talent of Jim Thorne. His maneuverability is there. Now, he still has the option of passing or running, but he makes a decision. He makes a great cutback because he wanted to run the ball. A lot of quarterbacks would have had a lot of indecision there.
Efren Herrera kicks it up, and it's good. With 59 seconds left in the first quarter, they're dancing in the Pacific Northwest. Seattle 13 and Minnesota Vikings nothing.
I'll tell you, Benny, Jim Zorn has improved so much since the last time I saw him. He is now one of the better quarterbacks in the National Football League.
He had a knee injury last year and missed four games, but there's nothing wrong with the knee that carried him in the end zone on this play.
You see, he saw that the coverage had blanketed his receivers, so immediately he runs with the football. Very positive, taken over with authority.
They turned Jeff Seaman out of the play. Paul Kraus tried to come over, and they blocked him out.
He's called a tremendous game so far. He's completely in charge. The Vikings are in trouble.
So the underdog, Seattle Seahawks, surprisingly leading Minnesota 13 to nothing. Efren Herrera, formerly with Dallas, will tee it up. Kevin Miller going deep on the goal line, and once again, he'll be flanked by Sammy White and Robert Miller.
Yes.
Efren Herrera, four-year man out of UCLA. And George and Jim, you hinted about a possible upset, and we're looking at it, even though it's so early in the first quarter. Herrera sends it away, and it'll be Kevin Miller coming up on a short kick at the 10 to the 20, 25, and down he goes. Pete Cronin, number 57, the man to hit him first. Cleveland has increased its lead over New Orleans now, 24 to 9 in the fourth.
The Vikings need a big play to get back in. That extra point they missed, Seattle missed, still is a factor, but the Vikes need a big play here.
First and 10 from the Viking 28. Rashad left, Sammy White in a slot left. Tucker the tight end on the right side. Here's Ricky Young with Robert Miller blocking. And down he goes. And by the way, Cornell Webster is back in there, number 38. He was the one who jammed it as Miller was coming up to block. So yeah. Webster filling in for Keith Simpson.
We might bring out once again that Chuck Foreman is not in the ball game. He represents so much offense. Minnesota, they're missing him dearly right now.
Yeah, Jim, but Bud Grant and this team is built on a team concept. No question they miss Foreman, but they've got other good men that take over, and that's how they built the ball club.
That's Robert Miller spinning his way out to the 40-yard line.
And those guys have to come
first
through
down
to win games like this. You can't always have all your key people.
Chuck Foreman standing on the sidelines, a 1,000-yarder for three straight years. In fact, he's averaged 960 yards for 6 years. Last year, he caught 51 passes as an average in his career. But at Seattle 13, Minnesota nothing as Foreman looks on.
I'd like to show you how science helped create a new Mercury Marquee standard of driving comfort for 79. The most scientifically engineered marquee in history and most beautiful. Computer-assisted design makes marquee more spacious. No car in its class has higher ratings for room or trunk space. A new steering ratio makes marquee more responsive. Even marquee's ride has been re-engineered. Corners flatter, takes dips and bumps with greater stability. Test marquee's new standard of driving comfort yourself.
Homeward Bound, coast of New England.
The Navy. See your recruiter or call toll free. It's not just a job, it's an adventure.
Where might you be going with that?
Same place you're going, Father. I'll check it straight through for you. You better hurry.
Man, it looks like I got about an hour yet, eh?
More like 10 minutes, I'm afraid. Go to see
your satisfied. At United, we give you all we've got. Take off to touchdown. We're here together.
We built the largest airline in the free world.
It wouldn't be spoiling me now, would you?
We're gonna try.
The Seattle Seahawks stubbornly holding on to what is now a 13-0 lead, and the Minnesota Vikings trying to get back on the scoreboard. First and 10 from their own 40-yard line. Out of the eye with Young, the deep back, and he will handle it. Ricky Young squirts across the 45-yard line to make that a good carry. He'll still need a couple of yards to get a first down. The New York Jets ran up Buffalo and down Buffalo. Final, the Jets 45 and Buffalo 14.
Jim, I like what Tarkin is doing now. He's not trying to get it back in one play. There's plenty of time. He's getting his running game going, and that'll help his passing game.
Absolutely right, Coach. No doubt about it. You can't get rich quick.
After 18 years, I don't imagine we'll see Tarkin in a hurry. Second and three from the 47. And here comes Ricky Young, but he is grabbed by Bill Sandifer, number 66, and down he goes. Bill Sandifer, five-year man out of UCLA, he was on the injured reserve last year with a broken ankle. He broke it against Baltimore in the opening game. 6'6", 260, the Hawks can use him. Dallas battling the Giants, 7-3 in the second. Dallas trying to get it together again.
Here's a third and one situation with two tight ends.
Third and one on the 49. Tucker on one side and Craig on the other. And Robert Miller keeps going and makes the first down. Terry Beeson, number 58, the middle linebacker, went flying by him, and that made the play for Miller.
Miller had a real quick start here. His first quarter score of the NFL today, LA 7, San Francisco. No doubt about the start. The hole was there. His body position was low. Very well executed play, right, Coach?
Yeah, the thing that Tarkin did well there, he went on sound. He went on a quick comp before the defense dug in.
First and 10 on the Seattle 47. Rashad wide right, White left. Backs release, and Tarkin in throwing to Ricky Young. He gets the 40-yard line, and Terry Beeson hit him head on and brings him down. Also, Green was in on the hit. A battle, the Rams and the 49ers. That's a distinguished rivalry in the L.A. Coliseum. And the Rams leading San Francisco 7-3 in the first. Question there, of course, is O.J. Simpson healthy and well enough to play?
That was a good first down call, a check down to the back by Tarkington. Picked up 8 yards.
Second and two from the Seattle 39. Slot right, White is inside Rashad. Here comes Robert Miller. And staying very low to the ground, he's able to avoid Sandifer and Beeson and get a couple. Baltimore and St. Louis. St. Louis still looking for a victory, and Baltimore not about to let them have it. It's 30-17 Colts in the fourth. First and 10 on that play by Robert Miller, moving the ball to the 36-yard line. So Minnesota on the move now. They've been stung. It's 13-0 Seattle. Sammy White goes left. Ahmad Rashad right, Young and Miller the running back. Ricky Young giving to Sammy White, and it's tied up beautifully by Ernie Price for the moment. So White recovers and he goes the other way to the 20-yard line before he goes down. Ernie Price looked like he was going to be a hero.
A great effort by Sammy White, and also you see Tarkenton try
watch
to throw
Tarkenton.
A block.
Tarkenton does try to throw a block right here to the left of our screen.
Right there. Right.
On Ernie Price.
Great attitude by Tarkenton. Sammy White, of course, has great speed, great balance. Goes back to the opposite side. His blocker looked back, which was a mistake. Should never look back. Go and throw. But it was a good play.
That turned a loss into a game.
First and 10 on the Seattle 20-yard line, and the Vikings are on the move. Mark Keller is in there now, along with McClanahan, and it's Keller spinning and held upright shy of the 15-yard line. So Mark Keller, a three-year man out of Northern Illinois, played a couple of years in the World Football League, and he's in there to spell Robert Miller. Kansas City and Tampa, what's going on there? Well, the Bucs are trying to make Kansas City walk the plank. Tampa Bay 23, Kansas City 13 in the fourth. Second and five, the ball just short of the Hawk 15. Sammy White, right. Ahmad Rashad, left. McClanahan and Keller behind Tarkenton. Back stay in the block. Tarkenton over the middle. Broken up. Intended for Rashad. And John Harris almost had an interception. As a rookie, he's doing a great job.
Yes, he is. He had it, and it was knocked loose as he tried to put it away. Right there.
Boy, that's something to have Tarkenton going against a couple of rookie safeties, and so far they have more than held their heads up.
Well, this is a big drive for both sides, especially for the Vikings. Now we're third and five.
Third and five, just short of the Hawk 15. Rashad left, White right. McClanahan and Keller are still in there. Both backs release. Tarkenton over the middle, and he has his tight end, Craig.
Great call.
And he gets down to the 5-yard line.
Great call, Jim. A check down in that area is tremendous.
Great catch also, because
watch this.
He was a little off balance when he caught this ball.
So tough to cover that in this area. A check down is a delayed pass reception by a back. He blocks, then he checks down.
Steve Craig, the tight end, a 5-year man out of Northwestern, making a big reception. So it's first and goal. The ball just short of the five. Actually, it's on about the 6.5-yard line, as you can see. McClanahan and Keller. White right, Rashad left. Here comes Keller inside the five and down under a pile of blue shirts.
Keller on that particular play, if we can see it from ground level, doesn't really hit this hole with authority. He's a little too high, so that the first man gets him around the waist, slows him up, then they finish him off. If he had that body lean, that man could have never held him.
Take a look at a hand perhaps anywhere near the face mask as they're buried under that pile of humanity. Second and goal from the 2.5. Rashad is left and White right. Robert Miller is in there. The back's release and over the middle to Rashad. Touchdown. And he beat Brown. Dave Brown, 4-year man out of Michigan, and Rashad just took it away from him.
Good call. Beautiful execution. That's the type of pass. A fast goal. Rifle it in there. Man for man coverage.
And when we talk about Tarkenton, we're talking about an experienced individual who did not rush. He took his time, stayed with his game plan. Now he's got 6 up on the board.
Well, Francis, that would be his 6th touchdown pass. He's been intercepted 11 times.
Big extra point now.
Rick Danmeyer, first-year man out of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, and he kicks it through. And now the Seattle Seahawks are leading, but by less than 7. It's Seattle 13 and the Minnesota Vikings 7.
Give me an Anheuser-Busch Natural Light.
Just say natural.
You see, you doesn't have to call it Anheuser-Busch Natural Light, and you doesn't have to call it Anheuser Natural, and you doesn't have to call it Busch Natural. Just say natural.
Johnson's right.
Oh, you can call me Ray, or you can call me Jay, or you can
For
call
a great-tasting light beer, just say natural.
But you doesn't have to call me Johnson.
2 naturals, please.
Please don't ask him his name.
Name? You can call me Ray, or you can call me...
From blazing heat to paralyzing cold, season after season, the JCPenney battery has the power to start your car over and over, year in and year out. And it never needs water, ever. It's so dependable, it's warranted for as long as you own your car. If it ever fails to accept and hold a charge, return it with proof of purchase. We'll replace it, free. It's the last battery your car will ever need.
Mike Wood, who does the punting for Minnesota, also kicks off. As we mentioned earlier, he was a soccer-style field goal kicker at Southeast Missouri State. So he'll be kicking off. Rufus Crawford is back there to receive it on the 1-yard line. He's going to run it out. Crawford to the 15, to the 20, to the 25, to the 30. Still going to the 35-yard line. Rufus Crawford, a rookie out of Virginia State, who high jumped 6'10 in college and was a champion 4 straight years. Boy, he was high stepping.
Good return, a line drive kick.
CBS Sports Spectacular will be coming up next Saturday. And among other, in that Jockey Club Gold Cup, we'll see Seattle Slew and Affirmed, along with the USTA Women's Indoor Championship, World's Strongest Men, and an update on a baseball report. First and 10 for the Hawks on their own 35 after a 36-yard return by Rufus Crawford. Largent in motion to the right. And a play-action fake to Smith. Zorn, the left side to Largent. Overthrew him. He had a step or two on Tom Hannon.
Zorn was a little rushed on that. It was a good call, a good play-action fake. He had him open, but he was just a little bit rushed.
A score, Houston and Oakland butting heads, and Oakland 7, Houston 3 in the second. Houston losing its offensive coordinator. Now Bum Phillips running the show with Dan Pastorini trying to get on the scoreboard, but it's Stabler and company leading 7-3. Well, that was nice of the good folks up here to
make
an official welcome. Greatly appreciated. Second and 10 on the Seattle 35. Largent is left. Ferguson is right. Zorn on a draw. And it gets to the 40-yard line, and Sims falls forward, and there's a flag on the play.
I believe the Vikings are offside. His cadence drew them offside.
There it is. Number 72. You can see that's James White, three-year man out of Oklahoma State. But let's see. They're going to call it against Seattle for drawing him off.
Well, if you could see his head, he's bobbing his head. If you bob the head,
number 10, Zorn. Start head bob.
So, you got it, Coach. Head bob of Jim Zorn. Look at the head.
Watch his head. Zorn's head.
Uh-huh. Like a toggle doll.
That's deliberate. Voice, okay, but head and shoulders, no.
Second and 15.
Zorn was getting a little cute then.
The Seattle 30. Largent in a slot left inside Ferguson. Rabel wide right. Testament is the only running back now behind Zorn. Zorn over the middle to Testament, and he dropped it. He had himself a big chunk of yardage, but Don Testament unable to hold on to the ball. He's a three-year man out of Clemson.
Ran with the ball before he had it.
And he was the number two Seattle rusher and the number two Seattle pass receiver last year.
Yes, he's a hard runner, strong runner.
He was waived from Philadelphia. Give you some of the numbers. The Vikings on that drive converting 4 out of 7. The Hawks are 0 for 2. Third and 15 from the Seattle 30.
On that drive, Vinny Tarkenton was masterful. That was a beautiful job of generalship by Fran Tarkenton.
Jim Zorn is faced with a third and 15 from his 30, trying to hold on to the early momentum for Seattle. Jim firing at Bart. And he got his hand despite a lick by Hannon. Sam McCollum somehow held on to it, and Tom Hannon hit him all the way to Michigan.
Zorn really stays in the pocket here. He waits. He's not intimidated. They're about to hit him. He delivers. Beautifully thrown ball.
And he read that coverage. That's the guy to go to, number 84, Sam McCollum. I called John Thompson a half a dozen times when I was with the Redskins to try to get Sam McCollum, try to make a trade for him.
You should have got him, Coach.
Minnesota'd like to have him back. They drafted him ninth in 1974. First and 10 from the 50. McCollum is left. Largent is right. Well, they picked up Hilgenberg's dog, and he's throwing deep and overshoots McCollum.
Now, that happens when you're moving forward. When a quarterback is moving forward, there's a tendency to overthrow. Zorn stepped up. Let's watch him now. He sets up the pass, and now the rush will force him to step up in the pocket, and he's throwing as he's stepping forward. You see this? Now, that... And he threw a little bit off balance, and you always overthrow. He had a touchdown.
Seattle did a good job picking up Wally Hilgenberg, who was shooting from the left side. You can watch the frustrations of Jim Zorn when that one got away.
Well, that was a sure touchdown.
So now he has it second and 10. Sims and Testament are back there, and both backs release again. Zorn with a lot of time, and it goes out of the hands of Sims, goes on by Ferguson. There's a flag on the play. Jim Zorn, originally free agent with Dallas. In fact, you were telling us, Coach, that he just missed being with Dallas.
Yes, he did. Jam, illegal jam.
How did Zorn wind up here?
Well, the Rams had him signed, had him under contract. They didn't put him on the active roster, and Seattle picked him up. A good job by the Seattle front office.
Defense, 29, illegal contact. First down.
Take a look at the lower right-hand side of the screen, particularly Phil Wise, number 29. You see that push there? Well, Phil Wise guilty of it, and it makes it first and 10 on the Viking 45. Sims and Testament behind Zorn on a long count, and it's Smith getting across to the 42-yard line before Big Sherman goes down. Coach, you were talking before about Zorn, and you said he almost made it with Dallas.
Yes.
What was the difference between him making it and not?
Well, with Dallas, they had an injury. They picked up Preston Pearson and cut Zorn. Then the Rams picked him up and had him there for some time and had him under contract, but didn't include him on the active roster. And Seattle came in, I think, a scout by the same name I have, Allen, was the guy that was down there and signed him.
Second and 7 from the Viking 42-yard line. And a burst and a huge hole open to the 20-yard line, and a great return by Al Hunter, the pride of Notre Dame. First time we've seen him sprung today. Jimmy, he really moved it.
Oh, yes, he did. This is all because of Jim Zorn. He set this up. They probably thought it was going to be a pass. Set up beautifully, a gaping hole. You just don't block holes like that. It's all because of deception. He's running at full speed, and he's knocked off the speed by a block.
They got Al Hunter in the supplemental draft, Jim, from Notre Dame. They got him, I believe, for a fourth-round pick. Heck of a selection. They had him a year before they had to pay for him.
From the Viking 22. Play action fake to Hunter. Zorn now going deep in the end zone, and it is intercepted by Nate Wright. It was intended for Steve Largent, and Nate Wright, who's a veteran at stealing him, is right there to intercept.
Well, this was basically the sister play to the play we saw before. He faked it, he looked, and this is the kind of mistake that Jim Zorn has been making to cut out of his great ability.
My wife got the house, but I got the Sony.
Darn. I thought they were gonna give me a Sony.
Most people feel very special about Sony Trinitron color TVs, probably because Sony Trinitron color TVs are very special. You see, it's not just a TV, it's a Sony.
I hope he's not disappointed. I think he was expecting a Sony.
The taste, the great taste of Michelob, and made a light beer.
It's Michelob Light. There is no doubt. This is what light beer is all about. Good taste.
Good taste.
Like Michelob Light runs in the family. Good taste runs in the family.
Yeah.
Zorn had plenty of time on this play. Sometimes a quarterback can have too much time. You see this? Now the defense has a chance to recover and react to the ball. And that's
probably should have run, right, Coach?
Yes, he had a chance to run and pick up yardage.
First and 10 Vikings on their own 20 as they dodged a bullet on an interception by Nate Wright. Tarkenton over to the right side, and he's got Ricky Young across the 30. Young goes down to the 32-yard line. Tarkenton was 7 for 12. So make him now 8 for 13.
Nobody in football uses his running backs any better than Tarkenton. It's a pleasure to watch him work with his backs.
And a lot of misinformed fans criticize him because he's throwing so much to the back. Can you imagine that?
Yeah, that's beautiful.
First and 10 from the Viking 32. McClanahan is in there with Miller, and both backs released. The pass is to Robert Miller at the 40. Spins across the 45. And boy, did he leave Autry Beeman empty-handed, number 27, who used to play for the Minnesota Vikings. 14 yards. They sure loved Don Coryell in San Diego. They loved him in college. They were thrilled when he returned. He barely lost last week, and look at now. San Diego 14, Denver nothing in the first. Coryell is back home for keeps. First and 10 on the Viking 46. McClanahan and Miller, the running back. Robert Miller, the workhorse, with Foreman out of here, and they stack him up shy of midfield.
Jim, when we used to defense Tarkington, we used to feel we had to stop and defense his backs first in order to stop him. You didn't defense the outside receivers or the tight ends. You had to stop those two running backs, whether it was Marinaro or Foreman or Bill Brown or whoever he had. The backs that Tarkenton plays with usually are up among the leading receivers in the league. He does such a great job throwing to the backs.
Oh, yeah.
Second and six now from the 50. Sammy White in a slot right inside Richard. Backs go out, and the pass is to Robert Miller. He's to the 30, to the 25, and down at about the 23-yard line.
And
so the backs release, and he keeps hitting.
And this is what Seattle is not doing. They're not defensing the backs.
That was Tommy Kramer watching. Kramer, two-year man out of Rice, along with the idle and injured Chuck Foreman, watching the Tarkington Magic.
This is a perfect example of what you were saying, Coach, except it's a little longer than he usually throws to his backs. Miller's doing a great job out there in place of Foreman.
Four-year man out of Kansas. He was in two playoff starts, replacing the injured Brent McClanahan last year. First and 10 from the Hawk 22. A little release to Mark Keller, and is he upended by Cornell Webster at the 22-yard line. Webster, number 38, just knocked his legs out from under him.
Well, it's better to have your back get hurt than to have your quarterback get hurt. Tarkenton got rid of the ball. He was rushed. He threw a pass out that he probably shouldn't have thrown because really the back didn't have a chance. He can get hurt on a situation like that.
Our game very much alive, but we have a final now in the NFL. Green Bay, Bart Starr and company, defeating Chicago 24-14. Let's pick up Tarkenton. Second and 9 from the 21. Back stay in the block, and the pass in the end zone for Rashad. No good. He caught it away from Brown, but he was run out of territory.
Yeah, they rushed Tarkin and they dogged him on that. He made a smart throw. Throw it high, overthrow rather than underthrow. Here it is.
It is interesting, Coach and Jim, that they're going after a Dave Brown, a four-year man. They scored over him earlier when the rookies Harris and Simpson were in there. They left them alone pretty much. Brown was a first-round draft choice by Pittsburgh 2 years ago. Third and 9 from the 21. The Hawks trying to stiffen. It's 13-7 Seattle. 2:36 to go to the half. And it's Green chasing him. He got away from Green and throws it out of bounds. And it's a flag. And that time they will be penalized for loss of yardage, I believe.
Yeah.
Gregory, along with Butler and Tarkington.
He threw it at Yeri.
Ron Yeri.
Well, he was running for his life. He didn't have much of a chance here.
Green 56, Gregory 77. Here comes Butler 53, and he unloads. That's Butler. There's the desperate heave in the direction of Ron Yeri, and Ernie Price decides to give Larry a little lick to let him know what it's like to be around the football.
That takes him out of field goal range now.
They'll spot it to the 32, and we'll listen to Fred Silva's call.
Offense, number two, intentionally grounding, loss of down, fourth down.
So it is fourth and 19 from the 31.
A very interesting situation, Coach. What do you think they're going to do in this situation? Are they going to try the field goal?
There's Rick Danmeyer, I guess so.
Yeah.
Danmeyer is 8 out of 10 in field goal attempts. He has kicked around. He tried out with Atlanta in 74, tried with Minnesota in 75, Chicago in 76, and Minnesota cut him in 77, and they picked him up again. So Dan Meyer kicks a low line drive, no good.
You see, that penalty made a very difficult kick for him.
Well, Dan Meyer is now 8 out of 11. He was just too far away, and the ball began to slice away. And it remains 13-7 Seattle, 2:23 to the half.
Take any razor available in America, any razor. Now there's an electric shaver that will shave as close or your money back. The Remington XLR. Remington can guarantee a close shave because only Remington has this remarkable three-part system. The first head shaves close, the second closer. The unique intercept cutter is designed to shave longer hairs. The Remington XLR. It shaves as close as a blade or your money back.
Phantom of the night. Elegant. Elusive. Introducing the Phantom Cat, a bold, distinctive Mercury Cougar XR7 in midnight blue and chamois, with a hauntingly beautiful new face, elegantly styled, deeply cushioned, a luxurious Mercury Cougar XR7 called the Phantom Cat.
Isn't this your year to join the cat set?
Lifeguard, starring Sam Elliott and Parker Stevenson. A television premiere on the CBS Wednesday Night Movies at 9, 8 Central and Mountain.
Seattle leading Minnesota 13-7, 2:23 to go to the half. This is Vin Scully along with George Allen and Jim Brown. And we can check a couple of finals. Here's one, John McKay and the Buccaneers. Happy tonight, Tampa Bay 30 and Kansas City 13. Meanwhile, Baltimore knocked off the Cardinals 30-17, St. Louis 0-6. The Hawks, the line of scrimmage was the 31, so the field goal missed, and that's where they put it in play. Back's going to the left side. The pass is to Sims, and he gets to the 30, and they'll ride him out of bounds. So David Sims just off to the left for that little release from Jim Zorn, who, by the way, as far as his completions are concerned, he is 5-for-12, thrown for a touchdown, but he also threw an apparent touchdown away when he missed a receiver in the open and had the interception, of course, to Nate Wright in the end zone.
That's been the one problem with Zorn. He's been playing really great this year, but in key situations, he has thrown the interception.
He has thrown 8 interceptions this year. Tarkenton, by the way, came into this game having thrown 11 interceptions. Second and 9 from the 32 of Seattle. Largent wide left, Ferguson wide right. Howard, the tight end, on the left side. And it's Sims barreling to the 35, and down he goes. Wally Hilgenberg along with Jim White making the tackle.
Yes.
We have come to the 2-minute warning here in the King Dome. Seattle 13, Minnesota 7. Seattle missing a point after, and that could be a big one before this one is all over. So 2 minutes left to the half. Don't go wandering off.
Lifting all that weight makes me feel just great. Now's the time I find, got Blue Ribbon on my mind.
I've got Pabst Blue Ribbon on my mind. More and more lately I find I've got a taste for living. I'm thinking cold Blue Ribbon. I've got Pabst Blue Ribbon on my mind.
Naturally good Pabst. A lot to look forward to.
I always used to dream of castles. Never thought I'd go anywhere. But look at me now. I'm in the army, seeing things I never thought I'd see. Working away, that's not too much to pay to bring my castles home to me.
One good way to see Europe is to enlist for it.
With 2 minutes to go to the half here at the King Dome in Seattle, the Hawks are leading the Vikings 13-7, and they'll have it third and six from their own 35-yard line. Checking other quarters, a final score, Cleveland 24, New Orleans 16. The Vikings slow to get started. Seattle mile high for this one. Scored quickly twice. The Vikings have come back with one, and so it's 13-7 Seattle with 2 minutes of the half. Jim Zorn, 6 for 12, 124 yards and one touchdown. Hunter, one carry for 24 yards. Sims, 3 carries for 21. And Sam McCollum caught the touchdown pass. He's 3 for 75 yards. Third and six from the 35. A lot of movement up front. Zorn trips, loses the ball. There's a flag on it as Carl Eller picked up the ball, but we better hold on. Carl Eller, first round draft choice in 1964. 36 years old and hammering away.
Still going strong. Yes, against the Vikings.
And it was Eller's foot that kicked it out of Zorn's hand. Watch it, watch Eller's foot come up right there. His left foot kicking the ball right out of Zorn's hand.
Well, it was an accidental kick.
But still a kick.
They're penalizing him for being offside. Mm-hmm.
Is Fred Silva's call.
That's what the penalty is.
Defense, offside. Defense, 81. First down.
Tripping, I assume, was the penalty against Eller. So his flying feet got in the way. And that moves the ball to the 38-yard line. So first and 10 from the 38, a minute and 54 to go to the half. And it is 13-7, Hawks. Sims and Smith behind Zorn, and both backs go out. And Zorn going down the left side, no good. He had two men, Rabel and Sherman Smith, Sims in the area, and he overshot David Sims, and Rabel couldn't catch up to it.
Good rush there.
Yes, right. The pressure was the reason he overthrew that ball. In other words,
good rush.
The Vikings defensive line.
Good rush from the four rushmen. They are into their regular defense with five defensive backs. But four down defensive linemen.
Interesting, as we look, Dallas leading the Giants 7-3. That's a tough one. Jack Patera was a defensive line coach with Minnesota. He had Marshall, Page, and Eller when he was coaching there. Second and 10 from the Seattle 38. Sims all alone behind Zorn, and Sims goes out. He's going to get the pass to the 45. And finally driven out by Nate Allen. That'll stop the clock with a minute 43 to go to the half. And now Zorn is taking a page out of Tarkin's
foot. Yes, and Sims ran out of bounds to stop the clock. Smart football.
We're talking about Patera, Vinny. Did you know that Patera worked under Coach Allen?
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. He had the fearsome foursome, too,
right,
didn't he?
1966, Jack.
Lamar Lundy, Jones, Greer, Olson, Jack Patera. Talking about the Rams, they're leading San Francisco 10-3 in the second quarter. First and 10 on the Viking 49. Largent in his slot left. He's inside Rabel. Zorn has Big Sims, and Jeff Simmons has him too. So Seaman brings him down, and the clock ticking away with 1:33. Each side with three timeouts, and Zorn has decided to spend one right now.
That's good football.
So Seattle holding on to a lead and holding on to the football with a minute 32 to the half, 13-7 Seattle.
Give me an Anheuser-Busch Natural Light.
Just say natural.
You see, you doesn't have to call it Anheuser-Busch Natural Light, and you doesn't have to call it Anheuser Natural, and you doesn't have to call it Busch Natural. Just say natural.
Johnson's right.
Oh, you can call me Ray, or you can call me Jay,
Well, you can
for a great Johnson. Tasting light beer, just say natural.
But you doesn't have to call me Johnson.
Two naturals, please.
Please don't ask him his name.
Name? You can call me Ray, or you can call me...
Are we going to be the bowling champs tonight?
Yeah!
Are we having a problem?
Yeah.
Did I forget my press stone?
Yeah.
Take out the bowler, put in the two.
A minute 32 to the half here at the King Dome in Seattle, and the Seattle Seahawks 13, the Minnesota Vikings 7, and just as important as the score, the fact that Seattle holding on to the football. They have it second and four on the 43 of Minnesota.
Vinny, they have Mark Mullaney in there in place of Carl Eller now, number 77.
Well, we'll see how Mullaney and the other front four can hold up now. Largent goes wide right, McCullum is wide left. Rabel on a wing. And Zorn gonna put it up. Deep down the middle, and he's got Rabel to the 15, and he's out of bounds at the 14-yard line of Minnesota. Steve Rabel, three-year man out of Georgia Tech.
Well executed. Good protection, a crossing pattern. Difficult to cover.
He hits his man in full stride. That's the sign of a great quarterback.
Against a zone coverage.
And of course, the receiver takes it on out of bounds, which stops the clock in this situation. Very wise.
2 years ago, Rabel scored on an 80-yard touchdown pass from Zorn against Minnesota, and he's trying to hurt him again today. First and 10 from the Viking 14. Rabel is right, Largent left, the tight end Howard on the right side. Sims all alone, and on a draw to Sims, he gets down to the 10-yard line, and the clock is running 1:20 to the half.
Now, this is a good call, regardless if it gains a lot of yards or not, because it will keep that Viking defense honest. As we said, Zorn is mixing up his plays very well.
I would like my quarterback to use a timeout here and not let the clock run down that much.
Well, we're down to a minute and four. Second and six, the ball on the Viking 10. There are still two timeouts left for the Hawks if they want to use them, and they don't. So second and six from the 10. McCullum is left. Rabel on a wing. Sims and Smith behind Zorn. And it will be Smith. And he is hit by Matt Blair, and that stacked it up at about the 9. Timeout called right now by Seattle with 44 seconds left to go to the half. Here is the situation. The Hawks now with one timeout left. Minnesota has not used theirs at all. 13-7. Seattle scored all 13 points in the first quarter. Minnesota came back with a drive for 7 points here in the second, and now Seattle trying to get on the scoreboard one more time before going in. Fellas, we have time. A question. Coach, how long do you say in years does it take for a quarterback to mature? And Jim, how long does it take for a running back to mature? George?
Well, it depends upon the situation, how much he plays. A quarterback like Zorn, who is with an expansion team, gets more of an opportunity to play. I tried to bring Joe Theismann along slowly and play him 4, 5, 6 games a year. I think it takes about 5 years, has been my experience.
Jim, what about a running back?
A great running back can be great his first game. In other words, he can come in, have all the ability, and execute it. All he has to do is be a guy that can learn the plays and follow instruction.
Well, Jim Zorn right now, a three-year man out of Cal Poly in Pomona. He was sacked 12 times last year, that's all, but he did suffer a knee injury and missed 4 games. He threw for 16 touchdowns last year, and he has passed over 200 yards 9 times, and he has passed for 162 yards in the first half today.
Zorn has an option here to roll out or sprint out and put pressure on the defense.
Largent inside McCullum in a slot right. Sims all alone behind Zorn. And it's a big draw to Sims. Touchdown. Garrett Sims.
Take the pass and run the draw.
David Sims, as a rookie last year, scored 8 touchdowns, 5 rushing and 3 passing, and he's on the move again.
You see,
That's
of Zorin's play calling. As
yeah.
I said before, if that play didn't gain anything, it was still valuable. Came right back with the draw.
The thing that it does with a quarterback like Zorin, it puts pressure on the defense. You're worrying about his ability to run down in that area and score.
And he's got the ability. That's his sixth touchdown rushing. And hold everything as they mix it up a little bit. James White kind of pushing around with Tom Lynch up front.
Vinny, number 54 is Art Kuhn. We had him with the Austin Redskins, offsides, and put him in the expansion draft, and Seattle picked him up. He's a very good snapper, excellent snapper.
Defense, 72, offside.
It's James White, offside, and it's declined by Seattle. It is 19-7, Seattle, 40 seconds to go to the half. And remember, Herrera missed a point. It was blocked. Alan Page and Nate Allen had a hand in it. And this one is blocked.
Yeah. Line drive.
So, as usual.
Boy.
Matt Blair.
That hurts.
Got some hands in it.
That hurts.
That's the line drive you were talking
That's
about,
right.
Coach.
You know, the Vikings have blocked 6 or 7 kicks this year. I know of 6 for sure. They blocked 2 today.
Well, so maybe it's not just the line drive.
No, they do a good job. They've always done a good job on it.
2 years ago, I believe they blocked 16 kicks or punts.
Yeah.
Well, Jack Patera talking to Efren Herrera. Herrera thoroughly frustrated now. He's missed 2, and that has changed the complexion of the game completely. It keeps Minnesota very much alive.
Just think if that were 21-7.
All right. So it is 19-7 Seattle. Seattle also, remember, lost a possible touchdown interception in the end zone by Nate Wright. So they have really dominated play. Zorn has passed for 162 yards. McCollum has received for over 75. The running, Smith for 36, Sims for 29, plus that draw play that went for a touchdown. So David Sims now has rushed for 37. And we saw Al Hunter on one quick burst for 24. So Efren Herrera will kick off, 19-7 Seattle, 40 seconds of the half, and Kevin Miller is deep. He'll make a reception around the 10-yard line. Instead, it's a knuckleball, and it's hit right at Ricky Young. And Ricky Young, the back, is able to hold on to it. So a line drive to a ball carrier.
Yeah, trying to squib it so they can't set up a return gives Tarkenton great field position.
So Herrera, of all the people to line it at, as a running back, and of course Ricky Young with the good hand stayed right with it. I would assume you'd really like to hit a line drive to one of the big linemen.
You want them to kick it down, way down the field. They have 3 timeouts. The Vikings still have a chance to get a field goal.
35 seconds to go to the half. First and 10 from the Viking 44. Tarkenton getting a block from Robert Miller, going deep down the right side to Sammy White. He goes out of bounds with Cornell Webster right there with him. But they just used 6 seconds to move all the way down inside the 35-yard line of Seattle.
Plenty of time, Vinny. You see that poor squib kick allows them to get back on the board.
It looked, though, that Jack Patera was instructing Herrera to do just
that. Yes, he didn't want him to kick that type of ball, though. He wanted him to kick a squib kick down the field, deep in that territory.
But there's always that chance of that kind of ball when you try to kick
a
squib kick. You see, that's what I call a coaching decision.
First and 10 from the Seattle 33. Rashad left and White right. Robert Miller releases, so Tarkenton is on his own. Gregory putting on a little heat. Craig has it, and this time Craig is stopped just about at the 25, and the clock is going, and we'll see Minnesota asking for a timeout to stop it.
Getting back to that kick again, it's also the technique of the kicker in kicking the squib kick.
So Minnesota using one of its 3 timeouts now to stop the clock with 21 seconds to the half. And Fran Tarkenton coming over to talk to Bud Grant. How many times we have seen that, Tarkenton and Grant, with time running out.
A lot of time.
Coach, I realize it's tough to predict, but as a coach, what do you think they're talking about now?
Well,
what options will Tarkenton be given?
You have enough time for 4 plays here if you run the right type of plays. They'll go for a touchdown on one of them. overthrow them, throw it out of bounds, step out of bounds, and still leave enough time to kick the field goal. They have to come away with three here since Seattle put that last touchdown on the board.
Even a good coach in practice, well, all coaches in practice will prepare their players for exactly this situation. There's only 21 seconds. You're going to go in. They know pretty much the plays that they're going to use already.
I've heard of a two-minute drill. You have a 20-second drill?
Yeah. Well, also, they know the defense. We also anticipate the defense that we're going to get in this area of the field.
A reminder, too, for all you folks, we'll get updates and clips of other ball games, so stay right with us. We'll be going to New York. Brent Musburger, Gene Kennedy, and Irv Cross will be there to fill us in on the doings all around the NFL. Second and two from the Seattle 25-yard line. It's 19-7 Seattle, 21 seconds to the half. Rashad wide left, wide right. Ricky Young and Robert Miller, the running backs behind Tarkington. And the backs release, and the pass is to the left side to Rashad. He got away from Brown. Brown, and again they're going after him and they're eating him up.
Missed tackle.
Isolation out here, one on one. Missed the tackler here should have made sure he just held the man. He didn't have to make a great tackle, just keep him there.
Now they can run the football.
Now it's first and goal from the four.
If they want to.
Rashad left. And they split Young and Miller. 14 seconds to the half. We'll see if Tarkenton throws it into the end zone. He cranks up and lobs it high to Rashad. And hold everything. The ball is loose. A flag is down. And let's see the ruling. Dave Brown was battling along with Ahmad Rashad. It's a push, evidently, against the defense, against Dave Brown. Take another look.
The key to this is that Brown really didn't keep his eye on the ball.
27, pass interference.
You see, he doesn't see the ball. He sees it late. He's fighting the receiver, and that's what they call it.
Yeah, it looked like a pretty good play both ways to me.
Well, it almost looked as if it was face guarding.
There now, Brown, after the push, looks like he's going to make an interception, but the...
Well, it looks like he's playing the ball to me.
Right. He had already pushed him, evidently. So from the one, Tarkenton rolling out, he's going to keep it and go in for the touchdown.
Yeah.
Rand Tarkenton.
Yeah.
Running it over.
That's one of his favorite plays over the years. Runner pass.
For Tarkenton this year, he has done his scoring passing. He has not been running. That's his first touchdown rushing.
Tarkenton made a great move because he faked as if he was going to pass there, and then he ran, which is going to freeze the defense.
He could have thrown the ball, but he did the right thing running.
Oh, yes.
Rick Danmeyer, who is 11 for 11 this year in point after. It's good. He's 12 for 12, and that's the difference really now. The fact that the Vikings are trailing, but they're very much in it because Herrera has had two blocks. And with 4 seconds of the half, it's 19 to 14 Seattle.
The coach was absolutely right about that kick.
The kickoff has just killed Seattle.
That set the whole thing up.
A bad decision, or let's say a bad execution of a questionable decision.
All right.
Meanwhile, Bud Grant laying down the law to the Vikes on this sideline. And Jack Patera would still like to have that kickoff again. So
selecting players that are skillful on special teams.
Rick Danmeyer, veteran of only 1 year, Sioux Falls, South Dakota. Even though, as we told you, he's tried to hook on 4 different times with different clubs. He was on the injured reserve last year, but he's got a talented foot. And he is 12 for 12 in point afters. He is 8 out of 10 in field goals coming in. So Danmeyer is certainly doing his job well. And going deep with only 4 seconds left, you have Rufus Crawford.
Now there's
the right kind of a squib. Yeah. Testerman will pick it up. He gets to the 35, to the 40, falls forward to the 42-yard line, and that will just about be the half. And a very busy half it has been. The Seattle Seahawks underdogs, but at home. And as George Allen and Jim Brown pointed out at the outset, an expansion club coming strong, very tough to beat at home, and they are giving the Minnesota Vikings all they can handle, leading them 19-14. It might have been more, except for two block point after, and also an interception in the end zone by Nate Wright. And for the Vikings, they have been down before, but not out. So we have the prospects of a marvelous second half here at the King Dome in Seattle. As far as numbers are concerned, Tarkington 14 for 21, 159 yards. Zorn 9 for 16 and 162. They have each thrown a touchdown pass. Zorn has thrown an interception. Sims scored on a great draw play for Seattle. We saw Tarkington just sneak in for one. And as far as the runners are concerned, Robert Miller, the workhorse, 11 carries for 43 yards. Sherman Smith, 7 carries for 36 yards for Seattle. And Big David Sims, who scored a touchdown, is 6 for 37. And talking about Sims, let's watch that draw play again for the touchdown.
Well, the reason this worked is that the Vikings didn't expect it. They had just run the ball two previous plays, and you don't expect three consecutive runs down there and two consecutive draws.
He is a very talented kid, 2 years out of Georgia Tech. In fact, we might even see it today. He threw a touchdown pass to Steve Largent against Denver last year.
Exactly. He's also a good receiver, Vinny.
Right. So remember the name David Sims. And at halftime, Seattle 19, Minnesota 14.
We'll see. You saw it on CBS Sports.
Welcome back. Musburger, you're not going to be.
Has been blocked at 32 miles.
On the ground, Kevin Long exploding for three touchdowns. And their special teams, they were superb. Here is Bruce Harper, busting back on a punt return. At midfield, he was hit by the Bills, but they couldn't get him down. Harper stays on his feet, goes all the way. 81-yard punt return, and the Jets are off and running. Here's 18 of those 47 yards. Matt Robinson filling in for the injured Richard Todd. Looking now for Gaffney, the safety valve. Cuts around to the left side and goes in, and the Jets have an easy victory. Now around the league, the third quarter. Houston leads Oakland by a field goal. It's a tough defensive game. San Diego and Don Coryell try to upset Denver. Lead by 14 at the half. The game many of you are watching. Dallas ahead of the New York Giants. 14-3 or an 11-point difference at the half. Some of you watching this contest. The Rams over San Francisco 17-3. And the rest of you are watching this game. 19-14. Jim Zorn and Seattle are for real. Cleveland wins again. Sam Ratigliano. And let's bury the myth that New Orleans is always tough at home. Baltimore and St. Louis. Bud Wilkinson now is 0-6 with the Cardinals. Tampa Bay and Kansas City. John McKay doing a whale of a job. 30-13 the final in that game. And the Pack is back, as Irv Cross said in our pregame show. 24-14. They are 5-1. Best start since 1966. Jets bury Buffalo. 45-14. Big win by Walt Michaels. Washington pulls it out. More about that in a moment. 21-19 over Detroit. Philadelphia loses by 10. The New England Patriots 24-14. And it was Pittsburgh easy. They are now 6-0. Hey, Irv Cross, what about this guy, Joe Theismann?
You know, we wrapped him pretty hard about hot-dogging last Monday night, you know, when he took the ball in the end zone and took a safety and held it over his head. But this guy really has been backing up his actions. He had a pretty good day today, throwing the ball 27 times, completing 15 passes for 220 yards and two touchdowns. And this is a big play here, Brent, to John McDaniel, with late in the fourth quarter to bring his club back to win 21-19. Here's another shot at it. Added some bumping in the end zone here. It doesn't bother McDaniel. He comes down with it, and the Redskins remain undefeated with a 21-19 victory.
I'll tell you what, Irv Cross, he reminds me a bit of Muhammad Ali. Outspoken, but if you can back it up, it's okay. What does Pete Rose say about the future of Pete Rose? Back with that as the NFL Today continues after these messages from your local stations.
We're alive with the spirit of the great Northwest.
17-7, Houston over Oakland right now. You know, one of the high points of the summer, Pete Rose in that 44-game hitting streak with the Cincinnati Reds. But now, Pete, you're playing out your option. What does it mean? What about the future of Pete Rose?
Well, we've had one contract talk with the Reds, and we intend to have another one early this week. And our ball club as a whole is going to Japan on the 25th of October for 17 games, 28 days. And The draft takes place November the 3rd, so if I don't get together with the Reds before that, I'll probably be in Japan when the free agent draft takes place.
If Pete Rose went to another team, what would you be looking for?
Well, I have to look for two things, an offensive team and a contender, because I wouldn't be worth a darn to a team that's going to come in fourth, fifth, or sixth, and I'm a leadoff hitter, and I have to bat 650 times a year, so I have to be on an offensive team.
You told me earlier that the Philadelphia Phillies lacked a leader on the field.
I think so.
Would you be willing to go there and be their leader?
You mean if I couldn't get together with the Reds?
Yes.
Certainly, because I think they're definitely a contender, and they're definitely an offensive team.
All right. Now, speaking of leaders, we're coming to the World Series.
We're not tampering with anybody here, are we?
We'll hear about it. You know, during the World Series, Pete, always key defensive plays. Last night, of course, Nettles making a marvelous play against Kansas City.
Well, first of all, he's guarding the line, Brent, because it's a one-run ball game, and he don't want no doubles hit by him, and the ball might have even been fouled. McRae got around good on the ball. Guidry threw it inside. It was a bullet. I don't know. See if you think it's a foul or fair ball. And Nettles just made an instinctive play and dove for it. And, you know, if it's just in the fifth or sixth inning, it's a double because he's not playing on the line.
Jimmy the Greek says it's 13-10 right now. The Los Angeles Dodgers are favored to win the World Series.
You know who I'm going to miss in the World Series? Al Rabassi. Honest to God, that man, the character, the face, the mustache, it's incredible. And if you look closely at this piece, you can see the smoke coming out of his ear.
We couldn't leave without one final tribute to Rabassi getting even with Reggie. We thank our good friends over at ABC for the picture coverage and Tchaikovsky for the music. Hey, it has been a big day around the NFL. The touchdown pass is back. Let me show you some spectacular action. The New England Patriots with Steve Grogan at quarterback. Watch Grogan on this sequence. Pullback play action. Pump fake downfield. Morgan splits the safeties. Goes long. 57-yard touchdown. Patriots win it by 10. The play of the day and perhaps the year. Danielson, watch David Hill, brother of Jim Hill. Great one-handed catch, and the Lions almost upset the Skins. And the Pack, they are back. David Whitehurst going to his rookie sensation from Stanford. James Lofton in a 58-yard pass play touchdown package. Jimmy Zorns for real. This a short time ago in the Kingdom. Looking now for Sam McCollum. 55-yard touchdown pass for the Seahawks. Oh, yes, another highlight. New uniforms for the cheerleaders of the Los Angeles Rams. Jane Kennedy, aren't those better than
they don't look happy, though.
I know. It had been tough early in the game. All right. Let's send you back to your announcers around the league. We'll see you after the game if there's time.
It's halftime here in the great indoors in the Pacific Northwest, the Kingdome, with Seattle 19 and the Minnesota Vikings 14. A sellout crowd here at the Kingdome in Seattle, and they have seen the underdog Seattle Seahawks hold a 19-14 lead at halftime. The scoring quickly. The Hawks got on the boards, a 44-yard pass from Zorn to McCollum, the point after block. Jim Zorn carried over from 12 yards out. The point was made. It was 13-0 Seattle. Then Tarkenton on a drive hit Ahmad Rashad for 2 yards in the end zone. The point was made. Then David Sims on a draw carried over from 8 yards out for Seattle, and that point was blocked. Then Fran Tarkenton ran over from 2 yards out, and it is 19-14 Seattle at the halftime. This was the touchdown as time was running out for Minnesota. All on the bad kickoff. You remember that Seattle, afraid of Kevin Miller as a deep threat, and had a squib kick to Ricky Young, and that gave Minnesota enough field position to beat the clock and get into the end zone. As far as the first half stats, look at how close it is. Total yardage, 246 for the Vikes and 8 yards more for the Hawks. Offensive plays, the Vikings have held the ball 12 more plays, and they picked up 3 more first downs. In rushing, they're almost even, and in yards passing, Zorn and the Seahawks have another 13 yards more than Tarkenton.
Vinny, what the stats don't show is the field position that Seattle has had. The Vikings are very fortunate to be only 5 points behind. They fumbled twice, lost it once. They're in the ball game. because of their experience and Tarkenton doing a great job on generalship.
Well, this is Vin Scully along with George Allen and Jim Brown. Pull up a chair. It looks like we're in for a great second half. It was a wild first half, 19-14 in favor of the Seattle Seahawks. And quickly going in, Jim Brown, any last-minute thoughts as we await the start of the second half?
Well, like the coach said, it's very unfortunate that the Seattle Seahawks are only 5 points ahead because they really played a great first half. And I think they're only 5 points ahead because they do not have the same kind of experience that Minnesota has. So they're going to have to come out strong. Otherwise, Minnesota is going to be able to go on and win this game.
Yeah, Jim, and the Viking defense has played pretty well, but they're going to have to play better. They're going to have to stop Zorn. If Zorn puts another 7 points on the board, or another 10 points on the board, it's going to be difficult for Minnesota to overcome that.
Well, like I said, Marshall is 40 years old. There are rumors about trading Alan Page.
Mike Wood kicking deep now and coming up for it. Whoa, it'll be Rufus Crawford. Made a great catch at the 10, and he's going to get to the 20. Got a block from Hunter that sprung him across the 35. A good block by Al Hunter from Notre Dame, number 24, and it was his block that got Rufus Crawford some running room.
And you know what? Another line drive kickoff. These are the type that you can run down the opposition's throat. Well, you can't cover a kick like that.
You watch the unique stride.
The block
good
by
block
Hunter on
Blair.
Blair.
Watch the unique stride of Rufus.
Unique is right. First
yes.
And 10 from the Seattle 38. Smith and Testament are in there behind Zorn. And it's a little inside flip to Testament, but that was picked off immediately. What a scary play to start. Jim Marshall, at 40 years of age, was able to read that one pretty easily.
Well, it's a little shuffle pass off of a half rollout. Marshall, with his quickness, came down the line and made the play.
It isn't really as dangerous as it looks because the quarterback doesn't have to flip it off. He can hold it if it is dangerous.
Second and 10 from the Seattle 38.
Second and 10, 38.
Ferguson wide left, Largent in a slot. Howard, the tight end, on the right side. Out on a wing goes Testament. And here comes Testament on the handoff, dragged down by Jeff Seaman, but he got away. And finally coming up to put him away is number 29, and that would be Phil Wise.
Well, it's a reverse from an ace formation, one remaining back. Testament, we mentioned earlier, is a hard running back and will usually break the first tackle.
Phil Wise finally bringing him down, a gain of 2, so it makes it 3rd and 8 from the 40-yard line. And we'll see what Zorn reaches out with now.
This
he sends Rabel wide left, and he has McCullum with Largent in a slot. Testament rolling with him, and Zorn sets up, and he's going to run it. And Mullaney grabbed him. He fumbled, and it's recovered by number 76, and that would be August. Steve August, number 76, fell on the ball to save that for Seattle.
As we look at Zorn, this is a good call, actually, because he has the option of passing or running. He now decides to run. He doesn't have as much room as it seems on our screen. They're closing in on him. He didn't put it away. He was a little tentative there, and that caused the fumble.
Well, that first series for the Viking defense was a big one. They stopped them, and now they should have field position.
Thunderfoot, Herman Weaver, 9-year man out of Tennessee, once punted 14 times in one game in college, under some heat, and hangs it high. Kevin Miller at his 13-yard line. Slowed down by Boyd, and down he goes, but it was Bob Boyd, number 68, who came up to hit him first. So we're just getting our feet wet. 12 minutes and 25 seconds to go in the third quarter. Seattle 19, the Vikings 14.
When do you say Budweiser?
After doing this about 3,000 times a day.
After a hard tennis match with my friend Ron.
As soon as I knock this ball out of the park.
When do you say Budweiser?
It's everywhere.
When my mother-in-law leaves town.
After a long night in here.
Or when you say Budweiser.
Let me hear you say it, people.
Budweiser.
You have said it all.
With 12:25 to go in the third quarter, it is 19-14 Seattle. Minnesota puts it in play, first and 10 on the Viking 20. Rashad wide left, Sammy White in a slot left, Tucker the tight end on the right side. The running backs, Miller and Young. And it's Robert Miller outside, a block by Young, but he didn't get very far. Ernie Price, number 62, put a bear hug on him and brought him down.
Tarkenton will put you to sleep because he'll come back with these kinds of plays. He'll run the ball. And pretty soon you'll see that he will come back with the pass, and that's what he did in the first half.
Well, this first series on offense, when you're behind, the second half is vital. You'd like to move the ball, try to get a field goal, try to put points on the board, take over.
Second and 8 from the Viking 22-yard line. Robert Miller slipped, recovered his balance, and got out to the 25-yard line. Bob Tucker, the tight end, dropping back to try and hold him out. Meanwhile, another precinct in the NFL is heard from. Houston, Bum Phillips, Dan Pastorini might have some trouble in Texas, but for the moment at least, they're giving Oakland more so. It is 17-14 Oilers in the third quarter.
We'd have to defense the backs right now, wouldn't we, Coach?
With Tarkenton, yes.
Third and 5 from the 22. Tarkenton with Miller out, but he goes the other way to Bob Tucker, and he is brought down by John Harris.
Well, they dogged him, and he hit Tucker.
First down.
There's the dog. Tucker's open on the lookie. Tarkenton always worked well with Tucker, even when he had him in New York. In fact, Tucker led the league receiving one year with Tarkenton when he's with the Giants.
In fact, Bob Tucker was the first tight end in NFL history to lead the league. That was in 1971.
Tarkenton likes to have you dog him. He gets rid of the ball quickly.
9-year man out of Bloomberg State, Bob Tucker. First and 10 from the Viking 33. Play action fake to Miller, and Tarkenton setting up and then releasing to Miller to make it instead number 34, Ricky Young, and he gets across the 45.
Well, looking from the end zone here, we can see Ricky Young. Now I want you to watch this move that he makes, because quick feet makes a big difference with backs. Right there, froze the defender, went on to gain good yardage.
That was a rookie, Keith Butler, whom he conned out on that good
play. Makes that difficult is that's the second back out of the backfield after play action, and the defense loses him.
First and 10 on the 47 of Minnesota. Tarkenton rolling right and flipping it out to Bob Tucker, the tight end, and he gets across the 40-yard line, and he's down at about the Seattle 37.
3-yard pass and a 15-yard gain.
Oh, yes. Like I said earlier, Coach, he will lull you to sleep with those runs, come back and pick you to death by hitting his tight end, hitting his backs.
Watch how Tucker runs with the ball. Runs very well, and he holds it with one hand. We used to try to go for the ball and force him to fumble it.
First and 10 on the Seahawks 37. Tarkenton started the drive on the 20-yard line. Young and Miller behind him. Tarkenton looking left, throwing out to Ahmad Rashad. He is knocked out by Dave Brown, but it's a first down.
Perfect timing, Vinny.
Tarkenton now is 17 for 24.
As we watch it, this pass is actually thrown before Rashad is looking. This is practice. In practice, you work on this particular kind of timing, because you can't wait all the time until the receiver looks.
That's the way it should be, Jim. And also, it was another dog. So Tarkenton anticipated the dog, hit his outside receiver.
First and 10 on the Seattle 25-yard line. Sammy White wide right, Rashad left, and it's still Miller and Young behind Tarkenton. Tucker on the right side. Robert Miller still on his feet across the 20-yard line down to the 19. So the Vikes are really on a drive.
Good call. Quick hitting play. Not much of a chance for a loss.
A backyard battle in the Coliseum in Los Angeles, San Francisco and the Rams. It is 17-10 Los Angeles in the third quarter. Second and 4, the ball just inside the 20-yard line. We'll spot it on the 19. And here comes Ricky Young trying to run up the back of Robert Miller, and he has dragged down Sandifer and Price in on the tackle. Price, So that moves it down to the 16-yard line. That would make it third and one. How have the Vikings done? 5 out of 9 in third down conversion. So third and one from the 16. Craig is in there now on a wing just off Voigt. And Robert Miller. Boy, go down and Beeson came up to belt him. And Terry Beeson, number 58, might have stacked it up. Let's see.
If you watch the pressure on Miller's hands, you could almost tell he was going to carry the ball. He was going forward. And all of his weight forward, he didn't disguise that play at all.
Well, the defense anticipated going over the top and met him in midair.
Terry Beeson, who was on just about every rookie team defensively last year, he's a two-year man out of Kansas. He made the hit, number 58. Fourth and one from the 16, still two tight ends. And it will be a pass from Tarkenton to Bob Tucker to Voigt instead. And Voigt is jerked down out of bounds by Butler and a flag on the play.
Yeah. Penalty on Seattle.
So Stu Voigt, the tight end, making the reception.
Great call, good action. Fourth and inches. Face mask.
Face mask. Charge against Keith Butler, who came up to make the tackle. And he's a rookie.
Brian Tarkenton at his best. A lot of time on that play.
Yeah,
coach.
Well, everybody's playing run down there, fourth and inches. Everybody's.
Boy, does he have him. He has him by all his relatives.
Yeah, it's pretty an accidental.
He had the whole family tree.
Keith at his best.
53 on the mask, on the tackle.
Now here's this first series on offense for the Vikings. They're down to 5-yard line. Can change the complexion of the whole ball game.
It will also change the scoreboard drastically. It is 19-14 Seattle, first and goal from the 5. White in a slot left inside Rashad. Tucker, the tight end on the right side. Robert Miller following Ricky Young's good block for a touchdown. Wow. Ricky Young just took Cornell Webster out of there.
Tremendous block.
Beautiful block by Ricky Young, and Robert Miller carries it in.
Watch this block.
Nice to see a running back block as well.
Cut him down like a tree.
Yes, it is. That's probably the only way he's going to play for the Vikings. Bud Grant believes in all-around back.
First series on offense, the Vikings score in the third quarter. Changes the morale, changes the tempo of the ball game.
Second touchdown rushing for Robert Miller. And now we'll see about the point after by Dan Meyer. It is good. And suddenly the Vikings have turned it around as we take another look at Miller's run and Ricky Young's great block on Cornell Webster. Look at there. It is 21-19 Minnesota, 6:42 to go in the third quarter. 24-year-old Mike Wood, a rookie out of Southeast Missouri State, will be kicking off for Minnesota. You have Rufus Crawford and Al Hunter deep for Seattle on their 5. And Wood gets one down the right side. It'll be Rufus Crawford from his own 2. To the 10, to the 15, to the 20, to the 25, and across the 30. Rufus Crawford is a rookie out of Virginia State. He was a free agent, 23 years old. Boy, he can move it. Talking about moving it, you've been moving it all week. Why not get a chair, get comfortable, and look at that CBS lineup tonight. First of all, everybody's favorite show, the hard-hitting 60 Minutes. Followed by Mary Tyler Moore and a trip to a singles bar. Then more laughter with All in the Family and Alice, and capping it off, that great new drama, Kaz. We'll see you on CBS tonight. Great lineup. First and 10 on the Hawk 31. And it's Testerman running into a Minnesota team meeting. He gets out across the 35.
Well, the pressure is on Zorn and the offense now. This is the first time then they've been behind.
Situation where we get a chance to see the maturity of the Seattle team, coach. Right now, they should respond just as Tarkenton has responded. Take their time, use their game plan, don't rush it. Use a lot of poise here.
From their own 36, it's 2nd and 5 for the Hawks. They have Ferguson wide left, Largent wide right, tight end Howard on the right side, Testerman and Smith the running back. Here comes a play-action fake to Smith, then a pass to Smith, but he had his back turned on it, and a lot of heat supplied by Doug Sutherland of Minnesota.
As we look at this, there seems to be a mix-up in assignments.
Well, Sutherland beat his man to the inside. Thorne did the best thing he could, just get rid of it.
Sherman Smith, first, number 47, he's coming out, might be because of that mix-up. First, he let Sutherland get by, and then he didn't turn around.
Then he didn't turn. That's exactly what I was talking about, Vinny.
And Jack Patera's going to show him the playbook.
Yes.
Third and five from the 36. Largent in a slot right inside Ferguson. Rabel is wide left. Thorne looking for Sims, and he's got him, and he is belted by Nate Wright. No reception. Nate Wright just jarred the ball loose from David Sims.
Well, the Vikings defense has stopped them cold on the first two series of the third quarter.
All of a sudden now, the flavor and momentum has changed, and it really started on that bad kickoff by Seattle. It gave Minnesota good field position. They were able to get on the boards as the half ran out, and they immediately came out breathing fire to take a lead. Herman Weaver will be punting from his 25-yard line. Kevin Miller all alone on the Minnesota 25. Dropping back Tom Hannon to block. And Weaver hangs it high. Miller coming up to the 30-yard line, makes the reception at the 30. And is he ever belted by Boyd? Oh, number 68. Dennis Boyd, 6'6", 255. He really put the wood to him. It's 21-19, Minnesota.
Introducing Hertz takeoff rates. Save up to 35% on the average weekday rental when you take off Thursday through Sunday for a minimum of 2 to 3 days. Take off in a subcompact for only $13.95 a day. Paramount's $15.95. Granada, $17.95. Thunderbirds, $21.95 a day. All with no charge for mileage. There are some restrictions, so check with Hertz. Take off next weekend with Hertz low takeoff rates.
This is Vin Scully along with George Allen and Jim Brown. 5:35 to go in the third quarter. 21-19 Vikings, who at one stage were down 13-0. Talking about scores, Dallas starting to loosen up now, leading the Giants 21-3 in the third quarter. And San Diego rolling in high gear for Don Coryell, 17-0 over Denver in the third. First and 10 on the Viking 37. Sammy White in a slot left, and it's a give to Ricky Young, and Beeson finally grabbed him by the waist, and then the rest of the boys, Bill Gregory, among others, coming up. Terry Beeson, number 58.
Ricky Young is very tentative here. Of course, that means that the defense is playing well. It's a flying tackle, which basically holds Ricky behind the line. Not much to say about that particular play. Good defense.
No hole to run, no place to go.
Nowhere to go.
Second and 9 from the 38. Sammy White right, Ahmad Rashad left. Young and Miller, the running backs, with Sammy White in motion. Tarkington looking right and unloads it to Bob Tucker. He was there, handled one-on-one by Keith Butler.
Well, this type of a play, a sprint out where he dumps it off to the tight end, nobody's forcing Tarkenton. No pressure on him, and they're also not covering Tucker.
What happens is you put the defense in a no-man situation. In other words, they're not charging, and they're not really covering.
Third and 1, the ball on the 46-yard line of Minnesota. And the Vikings leading 21-19, 4:53 to go in the third. Craig is in there now along with Tucker and Voigt. They have three tight ends. And Robert Miller battling just shy of midfield, but he has enough for the first down.
What Tarkenton likes to do in this situation, Jim, is go on a quick count so nobody is too taut and jumping offside.
That was a good run by Miller because the defensive line basically submarine. They all charged low. There was a lot of pileups that he couldn't have gotten through, so he picked his hole really well there.
They've changed the momentum here, Vinny, definitely.
First and 10 on the Minnesota 49. They started on their own 37, and Tarkenton just trying to nibble away. Brand going to take a big bite this time, however, to Ricky Young, who appeared to recover and fumble.
to me. And it was Ralph Moorcroft, the umpire, who said no complete pass.
Let me point out something, Vinny and Coach. In the National Football League, very seldom will a referee call this a fumble.
That's, in my book, that's a fumble. He had the ball.
The umpire was right there, Ralph Moorcroft. It was his call, and of course, they're very angry, although you wouldn't know it looking at Jack Patera.
They have certain policies, Vinny, that they follow. Very seldom do they ever call this a fumble. They usually always call it an incomplete pass.
See, he started to run
on
the ball.
He caught the ball and took one step downfield when Butler hit him. However, it's history. Second and 10, Tarkin and Hunterson. He throws it away to Robert Miller. And just to make sure Miller will always remember it, Pete Cronin comes over and tried to bury him, number 57.
Well, this type of play gives Tarkin the option of throwing it away. It's safe.
Well, that was a big play and a very frustrating play. Seattle flag. Unable to recover the momentum for the moment.
Flag down, Vinny.
And Pete Cronin, along with Bill Gregory, out there huddling with the officials, and it would appear to be against Seattle. And suddenly there's a leak in the roof here. Let's hear from Fred Silva. That's Dave Brown, who has had a very tough day in the secondary for Seattle.
That's the new rule.
Now, this is a very key moment for a coach. Patera has got to be able to keep these guys emotionally high. They're still in this ball game, but they're starting to walk around a little bit with their head down.
The last series.
4:05 in the third quarter, 21-19 Minnesota. They have first and 10 on the Seattle 46. Tarkenen giving to Miller, who comes back, and is he ever tied up? Because Goodrum couldn't handle Bill Sandifer, and that stacked it all up. Watch number 68, Goodrum, and he just can't mudge his man. There he's pushed Goodrum out of the way, and Sandifer is able to jam up Robert Miller. Good play by Bill Sandifer.
Both players using their hands.
Using their hands, keeping that position.
Bill Sandifer was a first-round draft choice of the San Francisco 49ers back in 74, but he was on the injured reserve last year. Five-year man out of UCLA. Whoops, talking about UCLA. The Rams now leading San Francisco 24-10 in the third. Tarkenen rolling right, throws to Mark Keller. And Keller gets to the 40 and is knocked out of bounds at the 39-yard line.
Fred Tarkenen.
He still has about a couple of yards for a first down, however.
That was a Johnny Unitas-style pass. In other words, you can throw it slow, you can throw it fast, you throw it long, you throw it short. That's what I call experience.
And high, because Ernie Price is 6'4", and he just did get it over Price's outstretched hand.
You know, Jim, when we were getting ready to play the Vikings, we would spend all week defensing sprint outs, rollouts, the short passing game, and this is what he's killing Seattle with.
Third and three from the Seattle 39. Again, rolling right. This time Miller is looking for the ball, so he gets it. And he's knocked out of bounds, and he also picked up the first down. That's so easy.
It's like playing touched.
I'll tell you what else it does, Vinny. It makes the defensive men very tired to be chasing him all over the place. They hate that. When I used to play in the Pro Bowl game, they said they hated targeting him because they got so tired running after the guy.
Well, Robert Miller isn't getting tired of handling the ball. And Tarkington now has passed for 230 yards. A little here and a little there. He's completed 21 out of 30. First and 10 on the Seattle 31. 3:10 to go in the third, and it's 21-19 Minnesota. Tark going straight back this time, looking left, and he's got Ricky Young, and he's tripped up by Butler, but he's still going. He got by Brown and got all the way down to the 20-yard line. Great effort. John Harris finally brought him down.
Looking at it from the end zone, you'll see what I call attitude. Right now, the Vikes are on the move. Ricky Young refuses to go down. The great balance, the determination. This is why you don't want to let a team like the Vikings get the momentum away from you.
Frustrating for Dave Brown and Keith Butler. They each had him and he got away. So first and 10 to the Seattle 20, and the Vikes now are starting to smell the end zone. Tark rolling right, going to throw it to Robert Miller again, and he gets away from Webster. And he got inside the 15, and we're seeing some poor Seattle tackling.
Vinny, you're seeing a master at work with a short passing game, mixing rollouts, sprint outs. drop back passes.
But look at the tackling, George. Yes. Sure, the passes are working, but no hitting.
Vinny, you're absolutely right.
That's right.
It's about a young team. It's about a team that when they get behind after having a great first half, they sort of put their heads down, and they don't have that same positive attitude.
I mean, Tarkington is great. That isn't a subject of discussion.
Right.
But Seattle is not playing well.
This drive, a lot of sloppy tackling. No question about it. High tackling.
Second and two from the 12. McClanahan is in there now with Robert Miller, and it'll be Robert Miller in a quick burst across the 10-yard line.
Good call. Second and two, get the first down.
Well, they got it. Boyd and Butler finally slowed him down.
Cross-blocking.
Used to like
first and goal.
Used to love it. Had a special way of running it. You run towards one of the men and set him up, and then you break off.
There's Jim Zorn along with Lynch and Rabel looking on, watching 18-year veteran Fran Tarkenton on a cruise. Started on the Viking 37. First and goal from the 9. Tark looking in the end zone to the right side, and he's got his man, a touchdown to Sammy White, and he beat Cornell Webster.
Comeback pass, throw to the sidelines, perfectly executed. All right, looking at him all the way, drills it in there, and he comes back for the ball.
Right in the arms of the fans.
Perfect. Tough to defense.
Cornell Webster, who did not start, Keith Simpson did, and Webster having a rough afternoon, a two-year man out of Tulsa. So now Dan Meyer trying to make it 28-19, and he's equal to the task. So we have 59 seconds to go in the third quarter, and the entire complexion and momentum of the game has changed. It has suddenly become all Minnesota. 28-19 Vikings, 59 seconds to go in the third.
Here's 100 years of tradition coming at you.
Here comes the king.
Here comes the king. Here comes the big number one.
Here comes the king.
But why the beer? The king is second to none.
When you say Bud, the king is calling. Let's hear the call. When you say Bud, you've said it all. When you say Bud, you've said it all.
Twenty-eight to 19 Minnesota, as Mike Wood ready to kick with Hunter and Rufus Crawford both deep. And it will be Mr. Crawford. He's been busy today to the 15, 20, 25, upended by John Turner, number 27 of Minnesota. And Rufus hurls his way to about the 28-yard line. A couple of scores we can dug in. Pittsburgh 31, Atlanta 7, a final. New England 24, Philadelphia 14, final. Washington almost upset, turned the card on Detroit anyway, 21-19. New York Jets chewed up Buffalo, 45-14, a final. And 24-14, Green Bay over Chicago. First and 10 on the Seattle 28. And Zorn has to recapture some momentum now as he goes strong and hard to McCollum across the 40-yard line. Nate Wright knocking him down. First down for Seattle at the 42-yard line.
This is their first down. It's a good opening play. Going to his reliable receiver coming over the middle. They have to score to get back in the ball game now.
The first and 10, the ball on the Seattle 42. We have 24 seconds left to go in the third. Largent, who hasn't touched the ball today, is wide left. Ferguson wide right. Howard, the tight end on the left side. And it'll be a play-action fake, and Zorn going over to Largent. So he finally touched it, and Bobby Bryant grabs him by the jersey, drags him down at the Viking 45, first down.
Coach, now let's take a look at this. You said something about tailway jerseys. You don't like them. In this situation, Largent has a chance to maybe get away, go for a touchdown. He is tackled by the jersey.
Well, I don't say I don't like him. I like a tearaway jersey that...
We have to tear away, gentlemen,
at the end
of the third quarter with the score Minnesota 28 and Seattle 19. We pause for a word from your local station.
Since you're talking about...
This is Dr. Johnny Fever with a prescription for those Monday night blues, WKRP in Cincinnati.
Tomorrow and every Monday at 8, 7 Central and Mountain.
Take only as directed.
This is CBS.
This is Quality Control at Crescent Foods. Hi, I'm Bob Robertson. If you think sports are tough, meet Crescent's food technologists. They're demanding because Crescent's customers are. Like school cafeterias, big hospitals, bakeries, fast food restaurants. When these people prepare food, it's got to be right, just like in your kitchen. Crescent, it's the word for flavor.
Presenting the Little Cheaper Dealer over Lake Chrysler Plymouth, an all-American performer that's packing in the crowds with great deals on an all-star lineup of super new cars. So join the crowd and come to over Lake Chrysler Plymouth, the Little Cheaper Dealer, where you get a little cheaper deal and all-American service after the sale.
Yes, you can talk turkey, but chicken feet. Cause a little bit of scratch is all you need.
Over Lake Chrysler Plymouth, the Little Cheaper Dealer.
Around here, Sundays at 6:30.
19 Minnesota, Seattle trying to move now. First and 10 on the Viking 45-yard line. Steve Largent had caught 24 passes coming into this game. That's the first time he's touched the ball today. McCollum left, Largent right. And Zorn is looking left, can't find his man, and he's going to run. He's being chased by Sutherland and Blair, and Matt Blair pushes him out of bounds, and he has a hurdle to team bench. You fellas were talking about tearaway jerseys.
Well, my point is that I don't want a jersey that tears so easy that I have one of my star players, and I'm changing four or five jerseys a game, and he's on the sidelines.
There's the situation.
First of all, if I have a defensive back that's tackling like that, that guy's going to be sitting on a bench.
Bobby Bryant,
I want him
you
to
hear
be,
him?
I don't
after
want him to be
years.
Tackling, no, but I don't want a good guy keep being putting on a new jersey and out of the ball game when it might cost us the championship.
Well, the league has voted.
The league agrees with you, I think,
yep.
George.
Good Second point. And seven on the Viking 42. Zorn getting rushed. Settles down the left side, no good. The pass intended for McCollum, and Nate Wright, who has been a key to the defensive situation for the Vikings, broke it up. Third and seven. A couple of more scores to bring you up to date. A final score, Tampa Bay winning big over Kansas City, 30-13. And Cleveland upended New Orleans, 24-16. And yet another final, Baltimore. Pull the pintail feathers out of the Cardinals. 30-17. Third and seven from the 42. Zorn trying to recover some momentum as McCollum right and Sargent. Largent goes in a slot. Rabel wide left. And Zorn going down the left side, and it is intercepted by Bobby Bryant. He's at the 30 and down to the 31. So Bryant heard you talk about how you would bench him on that tackle. So he comes in and comes up with the intercept.
The ball was, thrown just a little behind. If he let him more, he was open. Now watch this. Great play by Bryant. See that?
So Bobby Bryant, 10-year man out of South Carolina. Picks it off, and it's still 28-19 Minnesota.
These are two of today's newest razors. The one on the right is the new Norelco rechargeable rotary razor. This one has two blades and pivots up and down. The new Norelco 36 blades in three adjustable floating heads and a new shaving angle. Both give you a close shave, but the new Norelco rechargeable lets you walk away from soap and water. Of course, they do give you one thing Norelco doesn't. Gotcha. The new Norelco rechargeable rotary razor. Still no gotcha.
The majestic forest lands of northern Utah. Phillips Petroleum came here to drill for oil and did it so carefully that this oil field exists in harmony with a sensitive environment, doing more than making fine products for your car. At Phillips, we have a word for it. Phillips Petroleum is the performance company.
This is Vin Scully along with George Allen and Jim Brown in the Kingdom in Seattle. Minnesota asserting itself, now leading the Seahawks 28-19. Minnesota in possession thanks to the interception by Bobby Bryant. First and 10 on the Viking 31. Rashad is left and Sammy White right. Miller and Young the running backs. And it's Ricky Young out in the open to the 35 before they stand him up.
You know, Vinny, the Vikings have scored on three consecutive series now. They've taken charge completely.
You mentioned earlier, Coach, that a quarterback takes a number of years to become good. And I think we see that in this ball game because there's no difference between the physical abilities of Zorn and Tarkenton. They're both great. But the difference is the experience that Tarkenton have learned. And it's going to take Zorn a much longer time to get that kind of experience.
That's right, Jim.
Second and five from the 36 as Jim Zorn gets some instructions on the sidelines. Tarkenton, who doesn't need the phone, hands to Miller, and he is dragged and slowed down by Simpson and finally brought down at the 35-yard line. That's young Keith Simpson, a first-round draft choice out of Memphis State, number 48. They think he is going to be super. Got him by the jersey.
Yeah, they had what we call a slice force in the backside where the corner comes inside. The linebacker goes outside, and he's difficult to block.
And once again, the jersey comes into play because that is what slowed the back down.
Simpson is accustomed to grabbing what he can. He comes from a family of six brothers and two sisters, so he knows about a crowd.
That's
the dinner
table.
Third and five from the 36. Tarkenton going to throw it over to Robert Miller's head and sails it out of bounds.
Tarkenton was rushed.
So they'll stop him that time. It'll be fourth and five, and the Vikings will send in Mike Wood to punt. Here's Francis.
He's got good pressure on him right here.
Keith Butler trying to get up after it.
Got the hands up, made him overthrow. Throw out of a well.
So fourth and five. Rufus Crawford all alone on his 25-yard line. Mike Wood has not been punting that well, and he'll be kicking from his own 25. He had one punt of only 27 yards, and Seattle eventually converted that into a touchdown. They were coming, but he got it away. And now let's watch Mr. Crawford at the 25, 30, 35, and that's about it.
3.5 hang time, Vinny, not too good.
Well, Mike Wood, as we said, oddly enough, had a reputation at Southeast Missouri State as a field goal kicker, but he won the punting duel with Neil Clabo. The first and 10 for Seattle on the Hawks 36-yard line. We have 13 minutes left, so we've got plenty of time. But it's 28-19 Minnesota, and those two block points from Seattle really keeps them short, where a touchdown won't do anything but get them close. Play action fake. Here comes Alan Page chasing Zorn, and he throws, and it's out of bounds, but caught at the 45-yard line. Sherman Smith made the reception as a flag on the play.
Flag on the play. Holding against Seattle.
I think the holding involved Alan Page. Whoever tried to grab Page. Let's say he tried to turn the page.
Nice catch by Smith. Wasted.
All for naught.
Offense, number 61, holding.
Tom Lynch, a second-round draft choice last year by Dallas, and he came in a trade, played at Boston College, and Lynch was caught holding Alan Page. So first and 20 from the 26 of the Hawks. Smith and Sims behind Zorn, and they get a couple of Sherman Smith battling. He was originally drafted as a wide receiver, but they love the way he runs.
You know, Jim, Rashad almost played with the Redskins. The year we had the free agents, we brought him in. We were the first club to bring him in. We gave him a physical. He was coming off a knee operation. He failed a physical. He could have played with the Redskins. And later on, of course, he signed with Seattle and then came to Minnesota.
Well, you've got Eller on the bench, so they say he's not starting anymore.
Second and 18, so Zorn in trouble now. Mullaney trying to get at him, but he's getting good protection and finally releases to Smith to the 35, to the 40, to midfield. Still on his feet and is finally dragged down. And that is right about first down territory, I believe.
All right, watch 88. That's Alan Page. There are rumors about him being traded. This guy was at one time the most valuable player in the league. Now he is still very active. He chases. He gave it for 1 second. He's looking for that block because you can get hurt there. But this is a lot of life now for Seattle. They can try to push one in, get back in the ball game.
They need a couple of big plays to.
That was a big one. It was second and 18, and they picked up the first down now to the 48-yard line. And there goes Largent in motion left. McCollum is wide right. Second man is Big Smitty, and he pounds to about the 46. Sherman Smith is 6'4", 225, and he can move.
You look at Alan Page again, you'll see that they're probably double-teaming him, triple-teaming him. Being aware of him, that means that he is still very valuable to that Vikings line.
Oh, he's still a great player. They had the angle on him, and he likes to spin out and pursue.
Looked like a stunt with Sutherland, and yeah. He never got off the mark.
They're also using their hands pretty well on him.
Second and four from the Viking 46. We have 10:45 left in the game. Largent in a slot left. And it's a second man, and there goes Big Smith to the 35-yard line. Sherman Smith of Miami of Ohio. He was a quarterback in college. He was drafted as a wide receiver, and he turned out to be the club's number one rusher last year.
Now, Sherman Smith is coming off of an injury. I mean, this hole is a mile wide. You just don't see those kind of holes too often in pro ball. This guy is their best runner. They've missed him. They were happy he was going to be back. We thought he would make a lot of mistakes, but he's been playing a great game.
Now, that time, right, they ran right on him, right at him, held him.
Tom Lynch.
Now Marshall and Page
out. Look at
that.
Woof. Tom Lynch has him by the heart and soul. First and 10. Play action fake. Zorn to the right side. Has his man McCollum. And I think he is short of the first down. I believe he is by about less than a yard.
Seattle is building character right now. They're not giving up. They're coming back. They've got some life. This is beautiful.
They'll spot the ball at the 27-yard line. So it's second and a long one. And Zorn with 9:54, the Vikings leading 28-19, and he needs one now. Largent right, Ferguson left, Howard the tight end on the right side, and it's Hunter in there now, and there goes Al Hunter, and he's across to about the 18. Nothing. That's plenty for the first down. The only other time Hunter carried today, he went for 24 yards.
I think you kind of like him, huh, Vinny?
Well, he's so quick and you don't
yes,
see much of it.
That's very true.
Of course, they got to rest Sherman Smith a little bit.
Here comes McCollum back in, along with Smith.
Now, I like McCollum.
I do too, Jim. He's a tough guy to defense. He's the deep threat. He's the home run hitter.
First and 10 on the Viking 22, and McCollum goes wide left, large and wide right. Howard on the right side, out of the eye. Smith behind Sims. Zorn play action fake, setting up and looking, and he's going to take off to the 15, to the 10, to the 5. Touchdown from Zorn. Yeah. 22-yard touchdown.
Well, here's the play. It looks like he wanted to go to McCollum. He was covered, and he ran the football, and this is the dimension that a quarterback like Zorn puts on the defense.
When he runs with that positive attitude.
A big point now, a big point. It's 28-25, and Herrera has had two blocks. And Minnesota, I think, offside. The kick is good. We'll take another look. There was movement up front. This is Herrera's kick out of the hold by Jim Zorn, and he had a lot of leg behind that one. Now we will await and see. Was Minnesota off, or were they drawn offside? And in a moment, our referee, Fred Silva, will tell us, and the moment is at hand. Against Seattle.
He said Seattle pulled him off. Well, that's some more suspense.
Well, they kick again, but they get a little better angle.
Well, we'll see about it as they march it off. I don't think Herrera wants any angle. He had himself a point, and it's gone.
Ball start
False start. So now Jim Zorn will spot the ball on the 15, and it's a 25-yard point after attempt. The spot, the kick, it's up, it is good.
Almost blocked. Just missed the fingertip.
Now suddenly, Seattle is very much in the game. It is Minnesota 28, Seattle 26, and a field goal could decide it.
You must be ready for a beer.
I'm ready for a new Schlitz Light.
There's a new taste in Schlitz Light. The taste of natural ingredients brewed into a Pilsner beer. New Schlitz Light. Still less filling, with a taste that's bigger than light.
We climbed it because it was there.
And we came back down because this was here.
Schlitz Light. Natural Pilsner beer.
Hey, nice. Where'd you get it?
Avis Rent-A-Car.
Avis introduces rent-a-cars you wish you owned, like the Chevy Caprice.
I think I'll park it myself.
The Cadillac Sedan DeVille. The Olds Cutlass. Buick Regal. The Pontiac Grand Prix. Rent-a-cars you wish you owned. Avis now features...
Seattle goes 64 yards in seven plays. Jim Zorn running it in from 22 yards out. And it's Minnesota 28, Seattle 26. 9 minutes left to go in the game as Efren Herrera will tee it up on the 35. Kevin Miller is deep, standing on his own four-yard line. Sammy White and Robert Miller are flanking him left and right, respectively. So Efren Herrera out of Guadalajara. Graduate of UCLA, kicking off for Seattle. This one going and drifting to the right side, and it's Kevin Miller from the 5 to the 25, still on his feet to about the 29, where Minnesota will put it in play first and 10. Let's go back and look at Jim Zorn, fellas.
Well, I think the big thing here is Zorn, his team could have folded, or he could have not come through, and he led this drive all the way to a touchdown. I think this shows how he has developed his confidence, his poise, and he's going to be a fine quarterback. No question about that.
All right, Minnesota now trying to battle back. First and 10 in the 30. The Vikings leading 28-26, 8:50 to go in the game. Young and Miller, the running backs. And Tarkenen looking for Young, and he's got him at the 20. To the 30-yard line, Keith Butler and Dave Brown couldn't tackle him, but Beeson and Sandifer and Price could.
The fans are coming alive now.
Ed got it just back to the line of scrimmage, that's all. Though it is second and 10 from the Viking 30. This big crowd, a sellout here in Seattle. Minnesota beat Seattle in a high double-figure game the only other time they met, and this one's even better. 28-26 Vikings, 8 minutes and 12 seconds left, second and 10 from the 30. Tark going to put it up, only he's going deep for Sammy White, broken up. John Harris, number 44, the kid was right there, along with Autry Beeman. And Autry Beeman, number 27, used to play for Minnesota.
This call could have actually been intercepted. It's a surprise call, in my opinion, by Tarkenton. I thought he would do what he's been doing before. Coach, you might have an opinion on that.
Well, he felt he could get a big one there and break their back a little bit. He surprised me, too, on that. But he was well covered.
Jim Zorn and the offensive team for the Vikings, for Seattle, waiting for the Vikings to run out of gas. And here's the big play. Third and 10 from the Viking 30. Talking and looking to his right. Now going to go down the middle, and he's got Bob Tucker, but it's not enough. Tucker did not make it. He's a little hot. And tied up with him there is Charles McShane, number 59.
Another example where this is a game of inches.
So they stopped him. The Hawks just stopped tight end Bob Tucker, who made the reception.
Keith Butler got him high and almost took his head off.
Sometimes they call that. That's clubbing.
Butler is the same fellow who was caught for grabbing the mask earlier.
He clubbed him with his forearm.
Look out here. Fourth and two. Mike Wood.
Vikings need a big punt here.
And deep is Rufus Crawford. They're coming. And he got it away. And Crawford all alone on his 20-yard line. And Rufus gets by Blair only for a couple. Matt Blair tripped him up. And down he goes at about the 28-yard line. Boy, that Matt Blair's quick.
Yes, he is.
Oh. And a lot of pressure on Efren Herrera. He is yet to be heard from today.
In this 60-second briefing, I'd like to show you how science can affect the way you drive in a Mercury Marquis. Because science has helped create a new Mercury Marquis standard of driving comfort for 79. The most scientifically engineered Marquis in history. Its new styling is more than just beautiful. It's more aerodynamic than last year. Computer-assisted design makes Marquis more spacious than last year. No car in its class has higher ratings for room or trunk space. Expanded glass area and re-engineered seating create a new command position for the driver. A new steering ratio makes Marquis more responsive. A tighter turning diameter provides increased maneuverability. Even Marquis' ride has been re-engineered with all new suspension geometry. Corners flatter, takes dips and bumps with greater stability. Test Marquis' new standard of driving comfort yourself.
At the sign of the cat.
Next Saturday, CBS Sports Spectacular features highlights of the USTA Women's Indoor Championships, part two of the world's strongest men competition, and more. You'll see. You saw it on CBS Sports.
Minnesota 28, Seattle 26, 7 minutes and 4 seconds left to go, and Seattle has the ball, first and 10 on the Hawks' 29-yard line. Zorn will send McCollum left, and a slot goes Largent. Howard, the tight end on the right side. And it's Smith and Sims, the running backs, out of the eye. And here comes Big Smith across the 30 to the 35-yard line. So he picked up 6 just as fast as you could say, Sherman Smith.
This particular play has been working well for Zorn. This play, he also passes off of. He fakes to the back going through and then throw a pass. So you can watch for that at a later time.
Well, it's good to run on first down with your best back. You've just scored. Take the pass rush away from the Vikings. The Vikings are thinking pass.
A pickup of 6, so it's 2nd and 4 on the Hawk 35. And Sims on a wing outside Howard, slot right. And here's a play to Smith, and he is upended at the 35-yard line. It was Bobby Bryant who earlier made a key interception to come up and make the tackle. Herman Weaver, 9 years out of Tennessee and a marvelous punter, but, and it's a footnote to the story, during the practice this week, Seattle spent considerable amount of time having Herman Weaver pass out of punt formation. Meanwhile, Efren Herrera could conceivably kick a field goal to decide it. He has only kicked 2 out of 6. So 3rd and 4 from the 35 of Seattle. Play action fake. And Zorn fakes once. He's going to have to keep it. He didn't want to keep it. And he's very close to the first down. It depends on where they mark it.
Well, he had a play action pass, faking the late. Nobody open.
The key to this situation is that Zorn didn't really know where that first down marker was. I think if he knew here, he could have gotten the first down. Maybe not. It's a good tackle.
They're going to measure. It is that close. But from our angle, it doesn't look like he made it. But angles don't mean a thing.
Here's an decision where the fans will think if he didn't make it that he should go for it, you see. And the best thing to do with
inches,
5 minutes and 29 seconds, is punt the football.
Well, the crowd is saying go.
If you listen to the crowd here and go for it, you don't make it, the ball game might be over.
Well, they're going for it, coach, I believe.
Well, coaches always want you to kick, and players always want to go for it along with the fans.
Jim Zorn is indicating and has gotten the go-ahead from Jack Patera. So it is 4th down.
Well, it
inches.
It's showing confidence in your offense.
Well, now let's see. You have Smith and Sims, and they've been the workhorse. Smith particularly. He's number 47. We'll see if they give it to Big Sherman. Fourth and inches to keep the drive going. Nope, they go to Sims, and he's got it. First down, Seattle. They went to David Sims, a second-year man out of Georgia Tech.
Yeah, it's one of those plays, calls. It's a good if you make it, and if you
don't, it's bad.
If you don't, it costs you the ball game.
You know what, though? It's show business. Seattle doesn't expect to go anywhere this year anyway. You have a sellout crowd. What do you got to lose? You're not going to lose a shot at the Super Bowl.
Absolutely right.
It's good. From that standpoint, Vinny, it's a good call with this situation, this team.
That's right. First and 10 from the 40, and of course, that really pumps them up here. Here comes McCollum wide right, Largent in the slot left, Howard the tight end on the left side. Smith and Sims, play action fake to Sims, and now the release to big tight end Ron Howard, and Jeff Seaman knocked him down.
Seaman's read that perfectly.
Well, he's such a great one, coach.
Watch Seaman's number 50, right over there.
So Jeff Seaman just following the tight end Ron Howard to handle him easily. Howard came to Seattle from Dallas, a five-year man, and he went to school here at the University of Seattle, number 87. All right, second and 7 on the Hawks 43. It is 28-26 Vikings, 4 minutes left in the game. Second man, Smith, and there he goes. To the Viking 45. He carried Tom Hannon with him, number 45.
That's a good call. Another
Vikings
good call.
Have really not been able to defense this particular play. They're running it to one side, they're running it to the other side. It's highly successful. If they don't watch out, he's probably going to throw a great pass off of that same play.
Well, Sherman Smith, by the way, has rushed now for 67 yards. Meanwhile, Duke Ferguson and Phil Wise exchange a few dukes, and it's first and 10 on the Viking 46. Hunter is in there and stays in to block. Zorn got away from one man, got away from White, and finally Eller, who missed him the first time, brought him down. But they're sputtering now. It'll be second and 10. A big battle, and Oakland came out on top. Even though Houston was leading last time we saw it, it's Oakland 21, Houston 17, a final.
Well, they're getting a little more pressure on Zorn. Nobody open. Good pursuit, nice tackle by Eller.
Second and 11 on the Viking 47. McCollum wide left, Largent right. Rabel on a wing. And they split the back, Smith and Sims. Zorn looking left, throwing left. He's got his man, and it's Sherman Smith, and it just depends on where Bryant hit him along with McNeil.
He's short.
He's going to be short by inches on the hit. They thought that Smith had made the first down, but both McNeil and Bryant hit him inches before the first down.
It's a good throw. Good defensive play, too, because they were aware of where that first down marker was. They did not want him to get it.
Efren Herrera has kicked two field goals, one inside from 20 to 29, and his one long one was between the 40 and the 49. But he has not been kicking that well. Two out of six field goals, and he's going to be called on soon. 35 is Sims, and there goes Sims for the first down.
Efren's glad to see that.
Watch out, George.
First down to the Viking 33-yard line, and a timeout. The two-minute warning. 28-26 Minnesota. Whoa, don't go away.
Energy for a stronger America.
To Exxon geologists, these remote canyon landscapes aren't just scenery. They're clues to where uranium may be found.
Drilling, studying rocks, and probing for radioactivity help us find the uranium that may someday provide electricity for your home. Right now, hundreds of geologists are leading Exxon's search for new deposits of uranium and other forms of energy. Energy for you and energy for a strong America.
Looky there, little fella. Begin with an itty-bitty can of Budweiser.
Ah, yes, it's straight from the horse's mouth. But seriously, folks, we call it the Bud Half Pint. It's 8 easy-tasting ounces of the king of beers. It's perfect when you want a lot of quality, a little at a time. When you say Bud Half Pint, you've said it all.
Wrong, Eduardo. You've said it short.
How come I'm always the straight man?
Vin Scully, along with George Allen and Jim Brown. 1:57 left in the game. Minnesota leading 28-26. Seattle started on its own 29, and they've moved the ball to the Viking 32, where they have it first and 10. And they are slowly but surely getting into field goal range for Efren Herrera, who is 2 for 6. But today, Alan Page and Matt Blair have blocked 2 of his point after touchdown.
The strategy here is whether you keep it on the ground and get closer for a field goal, or where do you throw the ball and risk the chance of interception.
He's going to throw it, and Zorn unloading to Smith to the 25, to the 20, to the 18-yard line, and they're in the field goal range now.
That's what Efren likes to see there. Now he's got good field goal position.
We have 1:41 left to go in the great indoors of the Pacific Northwest, and all alone with his thoughts, nobody on the ball club, Espanol, right now.
The last play, the Vikings dogged. Zorn dumped it off. Good play.
The first and 10, the ball is on the Vikings 17-yard line. Largent wide left, McCollum wide right, Howard the tight end on the left side. 1:10 left in the game. Zorn on a draw to Sims. He's inside the 10-yard line.
Good call.
Oh, what a call. A draw to David Sims.
Got to keep it on the ground now. They're that close. Good call. Tremendous call.
56 seconds left in the game. 28-26 Minnesota. But the Seahawks are on the move.
Fake the pass, run the draw.
45 seconds and counting. The Vikings came in here 3-2. The Seahawks 2-3. David Sims hurt his ankle on that play, so they're going to have to finish without him. Testament is now in there with Sherman Smith. Zorn to Sherman Smith, and he's inside down to about the 8-yard line.
Timeout.
23 seconds left in the game. Timeout, and there are plenty of them. Neither side had used a timeout, and this is when a place kicker has to fight ulcers. He is all alone in the world. Minnesota 28, Seattle 26.
I see terrible things.
My future?
Your clothes. You'd look better in Hager slacks. Or a Hager sport coat and slacks. Even a Hager vested suit. All of today's Dacron polyester at prices that won't cost you a fortune. Now I see a romance, a beautiful woman.
My girlfriend.
My daughter, Imelsha.
Hager, because looking good makes you feel good.
For 1979, each Mark V designer has expressed his personality in his own Mark V. The Bill Blass edition, as sleek as a luxury cruiser. The Pucci edition, in the chromatic resort look he made famous. The Cartier edition Mark V, understated like a diamond solitaire. The Givenchy edition, aristocratic, elegant, very dressy. The 1979 Continental Mark V designers. Let one of them make a mark for you.
23 seconds left to go on a great one. Minnesota 28, Seattle 26. And Seattle just picked up the first down on that run by Sherman Smith. So it is first and goal. The ball is just inside the 6-yard line of Minnesota.
Then here's where Seattle has to play it safe, protect the ball, don't fumble it. They've got a real good chance for a chip shot field goal. Minnesota's been in this situation many, many times.
Sims is back in there, number 35, along with Sherman Smith. Largent in a slot right, inside McCollum. Howard the tight end on the left side. 23 seconds left to go. And it's given to Sherman Smith, and he is inside the five, and he broke a tackle by Mark Mullaney. He would have been hit behind the line of scrimmage, and Mullaney was unable to hold on to it.
They took a timeout. They have one left.
Watch 77 slow him up right there, but he kept on going, and it meant a couple of yards.
Well, if 77 didn't hit him, he probably would have gotten a touchdown.
That's right. He got down to about the 2.5-yard line. So it is second and goal from the two. Again, Zorn gone to the sidelines. The clock shows 18 seconds left, and Efren Herrera has a date out in the middle of the stage in a few moments.
Coach, would you not kick the field goal at this time, or if not, why not?
Jim, I'd run one more play with the possibility of scoring a touchdown and then take a timeout, which would also give Minnesota less time to score after the kickoff.
Sprint out by Zorn.
No, I don't think I'd sprint out. I think I'd, whoever's my best back, I'd give it to my best back and run over my best blocker.
Well, with 18 seconds left, you see Efren Herrera alone with his thoughts, as is the same story for Jack Patera.
The reason I wouldn't...
But if you did, to cut you off, but if you did that, I would try to tackle a ball. Is that possible?
Oh, you got to do that. The Vikings will be going for the ball, but the Vikings got to stop this and hope to block the field
Second
goal.
And goal from the two. With 18 seconds left, Zorn is asking for quiet. He has Smith and Sims back there, and Minnesota really stack in the middle. And it is Smith, and he's going to be stopped right there at about the two. 13 seconds, and the Hawks are going to have to expend a timeout in a moment, and it's their last timeout. And the clock is down to five. They better call it. It's
okay.
Down to three, and they have called it with 3 seconds. Okay, you're Efren Herrera. You're 5'9", 190-pounder.
Zorn called the timeout.
You're 27 years old, 4 years out of UCLA. You were in the pressure cooker with Dallas, and you finally were signed by Seattle.
They made a trade for him. It was a good trade. Now he has a chance to prove it.
Efren Herrera has had 2 points blocked today, or the Hawks would be tied right now.
If I were Minnesota in this situation, what we've done in the past is take a timeout.
Make him think more about it. Huh?
Right, let him walk around and concentrate a little bit.
To repeat, Herrera is 2 for 6 in field goals. He kicked one from inside the 29 and one from inside the 49. But he is only 2 for 6. In points, he was 11 out of 12 until he had 2 blocked today.
Well, he's come through in a lot of pressure situations for Dallas. This is a different situation for him. He's with a new team, entirely different program. He's gradually getting used to it. But this is what you want your kicker to say, hey, this is the opportunity I've been waiting for.
I think the big thing here that's on his mind is that he has had 2 of them blocked.
Uh-huh, and you can bet that he'll be looking for both Alan Page and Matt Blair, among others, because he's kicking against a ball club that had made a career out of blocking punts.
And another thing they'll be doing, Vinny and Jim, is they'll be talking to him. And they have 3 timeouts left. The Vikings have 3 timeouts left. I'd use one of those timeouts to let them think a little more.
Well, we'll see if they do it now. This drive started with 7 minutes and 4 seconds left. It has taken 7 minutes and 1 second to get to here. From the 10, it's a 20-yard field goal attempt by Efren Herrera. And whoa, here comes Minnesota over the top. It's Mark Mullaney who came flying through. But once again, let's wait and see whether they were drawn off or not.
Well, that's just like a timeout, Coach.
Offside against Minnesota.
Yeah. It's kind of rattling.
Hilgenberg is angry. Hilgenberg, I think, felt that Seattle drew them off.
Great game today.
Oh, magnificent game.
28-26, 3 seconds left to play.
It was 13-0 Seattle. At halftime, it was 19-14 Seattle. Encroachment charge to Minnesota.
That doesn't make any difference.
No, it doesn't. Herrera still has to kick it through, and Zorn will spot it just inside the 10-yard line. This is for the ball game, for the whole enchilada. Zorn pulls, it's up, it's good! And that's it. There'll be no more time today.
That's the ball.
The Seattle Seahawks have upset the Minnesota Vikings 29-28, and the great indoors of the Pacific Northwest is going wild. Thanks to the Seahawks and the Vikings for a magnificent game and a great job of sending the story to you by our producer, Robert Stenner, our director, Tony Verna, associate producer, Nick Freeman, technical director, Dixon Williams, audio, Roger Caven, to Dr. Bob Woods, who gave us a tight rein on all the statistics today. And this is Vin Scully thanking my cohorts George Allen, Jim Brown for a magnificent game.